have a TV?
No. I just like to read the TV guide. Read the TV guide. You don't need a TV.
Hi, it's Ken Reed. It's TV Guidance Counselor. You know all the rest of the details. It's Wednesday, which means it's time for a brand new episode. My guest this week is Mr. Kliph Nesteroff. If you don't know him by name, you probably at very least know him by his work. He's an incredible writer about old showbiz and the sort of underbelly of showbiz. Underbelly? That's not what I meant to say. I meant to say underbelly of Hollywood, and just a great, great writer and one of the huge influences for me in the last couple years for sort of exploring these kinds of things. He wrote an excellent article on Joe E. Ross for WFMU that I would recommend if you're going to just try to read one thing. But he's got a book coming out, which I'm very excited about. And Kliph picked a first. This is an issue from 1963 that we go through. So that's pretty interesting. His knowledge is astounding. I felt completely inadequate based on what he knew. And we recorded this at Musso and Frank's in Hollywood, which is very atmospheric, very fun. It was kind of perfect. I really enjoyed talking to Kliph, and there's some really kind of fascinating academic and factual information in here that you will enjoy. So sit back, relax, listen, get a piece of prime rib. That's really with some horseradish. That would be ideal based on what I was eating while we were recording. And enjoy this week's episode of TV Guidance Counselor with my guest, Kliph Nesteroff. TV
Kliph Nesteroff, how are you, sir?
I'm very well. Thank you for having me on the podcast.
You're quite
and meeting
welcome.
Me here at the oldest restaurant in Hollywood, Musso and Frank.
We're at Musso and Frank, which is why you're hearing the sort of clanking and things. I'm eating an open-faced prime rib sandwich, and Kliph is eating the cream spinach.
I'm eating the cream spinach, which sounds disgusting, but here at Musso's, it's truly one of the best things on the menu.
It's just spinach and like 18 sticks of butter.
It's a lot of butter. There's a lot of butter on this podcast right now.
Yes. There actually is physically butter on the recorder.
We have Domingo the chef in a tall white hat in front of the grill in front of us.
So Kliph comes here a lot.
This is a seminal link to Hollywood history. Greta Garbo, Orson Welles. Everybody lays claim to Charlie Chaplin, of course, but this place actually can verify their claim to Charlie Chaplin with its own booth in this same room.
And this is one of the last places sort of in this area that directly connects to that era of Hollywood.
That's true. There's a lot of old buildings around here, but they're not used for their original purpose.
They're selling cell phones now.
Yeah, this is mostly a tourist district combined with sort of... There's a street two blocks away from here called Wilcox, which is sort of like the crack house, flop house row. And then all the cheap, sort of ugly souvenir shops. And on Fridays and Saturday nights, if you want to pick up a hoe or a jock, I don't want to be sexist, a jock or a hoe. This is the neighborhood to do so. Put on your best Ed Hardy shirt and do some bumping.
Yeah, just maybe total some Jersey Shore. Mm-hmm. So this replaced sort of the downtown flophouse district, which is a part of Hollywood that fascinates me. Now, before I get into the detail of that, like one of the reasons that I wanted to have you on is because you kind of put me to shame with your knowledge from like pre-1980. Like I'm 80 to like 2000, but pre-1980, you're I can't even hold a candle. And we're the same age.
We're the same age, yeah.
So how did that era get in there?
I don't know. People do ask me that on a weekly basis.
Sure.
Why do you know about the 30s and the 40s and the 50s and 60s? People usually suggest their own answer. They say your parents must have been into it or your grandparents, and nothing could be further from the truth. They have no interest in movies or TV or music or the arts or culture or trash culture
or anything.
Any of it. My dad did used to sing me a lullaby when I was a baby that was a song from Hee Haw.
Okay.
Not the theme song, but Archie Campbell, the hillbilly with the mustache, did a song called You Were Gone.
And where in Canada was this?
This was in the mountainous woods.
This is pretty rural.
Of Canada. A rural route we were on, an RR number one.
RR number one.
Rural route number one, site one, compartment 16 was the mailbox that we had to walk to get our mail.
So I imagine that TV is how you sort of first saw all this stuff?
Well, you know, since we grew up in Canada in the middle of nowhere, the only TV channels we got were CBC, which everybody gets in Canada, and then we would get CTV, the other Canadian network, if there was a storm, it came in for a little while.
And that's the one that was sort of parodied in Videodrome.
Was it?
Yeah, that's the sleazy sort of station that James Woods is supposed to work for.
Oh, really?
It's
I didn't
City
realize
Television?
Oh, City Television was in Toronto. I don't know if CTV is
Oh, okay,
is
might
the
be
same.
Different.
Yeah, City Television was the guy who created the Canadian MTV, Moses Neimer, did okay. much music, and he had this successful channel in Toronto called City TV, which still exists, but I was on the other side of Canada, so we never got City TV. CTV, there was only two Canadian networks, so here yep. we had, in America, there's ABC, CBS, yep. and NBC, and in Canada, you had two networks, CBC and CTV. CBC had always been around as a radio station from like the 30s.
Government-owned, yeah, back to the days of BBC.
Public broadcaster. And then CTV was the first private broadcaster, but it didn't come along till like 1965.
Right, right.
So we only had one channel in Canada for many decades. So everybody watched the same thing. So there's a lot of shared experiences and knowledge for people of a certain age, older than me, mostly around hockey.
Right.
Hockey Night in Canada. But anyway, so I didn't get to see anything actually on television as a child. Very little.
Nothing.
We did get ABC, which had Saturday morning cartoons
right.
from Spokane, Washington, and watched that. But in terms of like the famous shows that now I'm authority on, like say something from the 50s, like What's My Line, or
right.
something from the 80s, like Late Night with David Letterman, I never saw any of that.
Right.
But then when we got cable in 1992...
So you're 12.
I was 12. I think it just opened such a window of wonderment that I overcompensated and
right.
caught up by watching everything all the time, from Get Smart reruns to Rocky and Bullwinkle
right.
to contemporary TV shows like the MTV Movie Awards to the Late Night Wars when Carson left. It was that summer we got cable. Carson left, replaced with Leno. Letterman. At that time, A&E was
Evening
just rerunning old TV shows.
Oh, yeah, they showed James at 15 a lot, which I used to watch all the time. Because thus far, what we've described is we're pretty much on the same exact path at this point
right.
To 92. And A&E would show a lot of the short-lived TV shows, too, like Police Squad and
right.
these six-episode shows.
In the afternoon, like, they had this block of like 70s and 80s detective shows like Remington Steele
yep,
and Quincy. Yeah, and they would show two movies a day, usually.
Yep.
They'd show one in the evening, and then maybe it was sometimes the same movie. They'd rerun it at midnight. And they also showed two episodes for a little while, maybe just for a year or two, of Late Night with David Letterman from the early 80s.
Yes.
There'd be one at 9:30 a.m. and one at 4:30 p.m. So I got to catch up and watch all of those and become a big fan. But I was overcompensating for everything I missed all these years that I'd heard about as
right.
I read Mad Magazine
right.
and loved, but had no idea what they were actually satirizing
yeah.
until all these years later.
And like Looney Tunes and Mad Magazine, people don't seem to understand are such great cultural artifacts of a very specific time and place that you're learning comedy from them, but you're really learning an entertainment history.
Yeah, they're referencing Humphrey Bogart
yeah.
or Bob Hope's sidekick Jerry Colonna gets referenced a lot
right.
in Looney Tunes, and these are obscure references for even a grown man in this day and age.
Right.
It's interesting because you'll watch Looney Tunes as a child. You'll have no notion that these things are from the 30s or 40s.
Right, because it's a cartoon. It doesn't look dated.
Yeah, exactly. And then when I turned like 18, I moved to Toronto, and I thought that everybody my age would be caught up to speed.
Would have the...
on show business and TV and
right.
movies. I found out suddenly I landed in the big city for the first time, and I was some sort of like...
Savant.
Yeah, I was an expert
yeah.
compared to people much older than me, but I just assumed everybody would now
yeah.
know what I know.
You were like, guys, didn't you do the pre-work? How are you enjoying things
yeah.
without having done
yeah,
your homework?
I had no idea. I got an inkling in high school that I had a bit of a television pop culture obsession, because you
right.
drop a reference and nobody knows what you're talking
yeah.
to. Or somebody wants to do something after school and you can't because there's a rerun of Dukes of Hazzard
right.
on you.
And it's like, this is one they never show.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So, did you guys get TV Guide up in Canada?
Yeah, TV Guide. We had locally, originally, one called Telescope, which was on newsprint.
Mm-hmm.
It was kind of rectangular, actually. It was taller, and they sold it at supermarket checkouts. It wasn't TV Guide. TV Guide's brand was mostly in big cities.
Right.
So if I were to ever go on a vacation to Vancouver, you would see TV Guide with the famous red logo. But locally, we had this one called Telescope, and it listed all the TV shows on channels we didn't get, which was
right.
infuriating.
Just tantalizing, yeah.
Back in the days when TBS Superstation was something
yes.
you had to pay extra for.
You did.
Can you imagine an era where you had to truly pay extra for TBS?
And everything started on the 5.
Yeah, 305, 335, 345, late at night, Gomer Pyle rerun,
right.
some random Three Stooges short. I loved that.
So how did you use the telescope to know that stuff was coming on after school? And
well, yeah, I really combed over the telescope every week with a highlighter.
Right.
Although I usually mostly combed it for movies, right. And they would have a little star rating, 2 stars, 3 stars, 4 stars. If it had a 3-star or up rating, I highlighted it, taped it, or watched it, and that gave me a big film education, which I probably know more about film history than television, but that really served me well. And it's funny, now at my age, I've run out of the famous movies to watch. Now I only have, you know, all I get to watch are like second string features, right, from the 30s and 40s that nobody cares about. Even film historians don't care,
right,
about
them. Right, right. But the real poverty row,
yeah,
houses.
Yeah, but when I go back and think about all the classics, like say The Thin Man or Bride of Frankenstein, all, right, the major films throughout history, they all, I can trace back my first viewing to my parents' basement between the ages of 12 and 18.
Yep.
The telescope TV guide. CBC used to show a Universal horror movie every night at midnight, or a Paramount movie, and those film libraries today are very elusive because they're, yep, not owned by Turner Classic Movies.
Right. There's like 40 different companies that have a piece in these things.
Yeah, so I think you and I kind of were lucky to hit on the very last era where regional TV stations still existed.
Correct.
Weren't consolidated, right, by media consolidation yet. And you could still see a random old movie at 2 p.m. because they had to fill time.
Exactly.
Or some old cartoons to kill some time. Now, everything that's a rerun is Seinfeld,
yep,
or Everybody Loves Raymond. Which,
nothing's more than 10 or 15 years old.
Yeah, exactly. And there's nothing wrong with those shows, but you do not just randomly see the monsters anymore unless, yeah, it's on a specific cable channel that only shows the monsters.
You can't stumble upon stuff as easily as you could when we were kids. And this comes up all the time. Because you have access to everything, you almost discover nothing.
Right.
Because you only watch things you already know about.
Right, right. You have to specifically search for them.
And did you go to the library? I mean, I remember I used to go to the library a lot, and there would be these sort of 70s books about horror movies. I'm a big horror fan originally. And there would be these kind of not that well-researched, but, right, very... It would be... I guess it would be like looking at Wikipedia or IMDb now for people. But you have to go to the library and get, like, several books and try to find sort of the truth in between,
well,
the middle.
Because of where we grew up, our libraries were not very good, but I do remember a lot of those film books from the 70s with the black and white photos.
Yep.
And you're immediately intrigued. What I actually had more of were like cracked magazines where they had stupid,
right,
captions,
right,
of like two guys that, like, going through an Egyptian tomb, and then they,
yeah,
got some cheeky caption like, where's the anchovies?
Right, right.
You know, and you're like, this is horrible.
Right.
But the photos,
famous
of the,
monster stuff.
Yeah, but the photos were intriguing, and I was like, oh, I want to see that movie,
right,
where there's a guy with a grease paint mustache,
right,
being chased by
what
a
What is the context monster. Here? They would all, Cracked was always showing pictures from I Walked With a Zombie.
Right, I
it
love
was
that movie.
Always, like every issue that, in that section,
a
it
bit
was
of
always.
Moreland.
Yeah. I Walk With a Zombie. So you're sort of educating yourself this way.
But I gotta say, that 70s era of film books. And nobody really talks about this. I don't think anybody's really put it forward as a thesis, but it's very important, I think, and very true in film history and television history. The 70s, the early 70s, all those film books came out then for a reason. It was the first generation of people graduating from college and university that had been raised on television.
Exactly, and they saw all these
movies. So they became experts by watching The Late Late Show or,
yes,
Chiller Theater or Creature Features or Million Dollar Movie, whatever it was called in their
Dialing for
city.
Dollars.
Yeah, yeah. And they became thumbnail experts.
Yeah.
And they graduated from university, college around 69, 70, and wrote the first wave,
yep,
of film books about Hollywood history and treating it as
it's
an
not
art
just
form.
Junk.
Yeah, exactly. So the 70s, because of that, you go to any library today, there are hundreds of movie books from the 70s.
Absolutely.
Some are good, some are bad. Some of them are mind-boggling because you're like, the internet didn't exist. How did,
yeah, how did you research
how
this?
How did William Robert Parrish write an entire 800-page book about the RKO character actors?
Right.
How?
He talked to them or something. It's, you know,
it's pretty remarkable.
Yeah, it's crazy. And that's when you started getting, you know, film clubs and midnight movies and all this stuff.
And to make it like accessible to your listening audience, this is the school, the world that Leonard Maltin came out of.
Yes.
It's the world that Robert Osborne came out of to a degree. So all the major film historians that came of age in the 80s and 90s started in that era.
Absolutely.
And it's an important thing. If TV had not been rerunning old movies in the 50s and 60s, a lot of history would be non-existent.
Exactly, because these kids aren't going, you know, some kids did go to the all-day Saturday matinees kind of thing, which was kind of drying up by the 70s. It was a very, 60s was sort of the last era of that.
Pre-VHS era, you can look at your TV guide and say, oh, they're showing that movie again.
Right.
This time I'm going to pay attention.
Set my alarm
clock.
Exactly. So you were very engaged and active.
Mm-hmm.
So, you grabbed an issue here from 1963, I think. November 2nd to the 8th, 1963.
Looks like it.
Yeah, and it's My Favorite Martian on the cover.
My Favorite Martian, Bill Bixby, and Ray Walston. Ray Walston never came out of the closet, married, but let's be honest, it doesn't matter, but Ray Walston's pretty...
Yeah, Mr. Hands.
Clearly gay, right?
And also, he's one of those people that seems to have reached an age and then stopped aging. Like, because this is My Favorite Martian era. He's about, he's probably 35, looks 45, pretty much looks 45 forever after that.
You know, if they were doing whatever that celebrity boxing thing is now, you know, where they get Screech fighting Dustin Diamond fights against whoever it was, Pauly Shore.
Todd Bridges.
Yeah. If they had that in the 60s, I think it would be Ray Walston versus Tony Randal.
Yes.
The prissy, gay, straight man.
Yes.
Sort of good at light comedy, but not really a funny guy.
Who do you think would win?
I think Tony Randal would
win. I'd go with Randall.
He's probably fixed in advance through the agents, and I bet Tony Randall's agents were better,
Yeah, I would agree.
But they filmed this show right up the street from here on just off of Santa Monica Boulevard here in Hollywood at a place called Hollywood Center Studios. It was also called Hollywood Producers Studio, something like that. It was Sitcom Central. They made The Munsters there, Adam's Family, Get Smart for a couple seasons, My Favorite Martian, The Burns and Allen Show. A lot of other TV shows, too, like Lassie, Perry Mason. Just a ton of those Filmways presentations were
Green
done
Acres?
There. Green Acres, Beverly Hillbillies. What's the other one in that trifecta?
Petticoat Junction.
They made them all there. And actually, it's a cool lot. It still functions today. And they do a nice job of honoring their history. There's a giant photo of Burns and Allen outside on one of the sound stages that overlooks the whole soundstage. But they made My Favorite Martian there. And, you know, it's weird to think of, like, TV sitcoms from 1963. Like, who was the audience? Because My Favorite Martian is clearly a children's show.
It is. And I've talked about this a lot on the show. There's a parallel between... My Favorite Martian's a holdover from the 50s, really. And I always say, you know, the 50s didn't end until Kennedy got shot in the early 60s.
Right.
And it's really from that era. But the 50s and the 80s, you had a parallel conceit of this, we have something magical in our house we have to hide.
Right.
You had Bewitched, I Dream a Genie, you know, My Favorite Martian. In the 80s, you had things like Out of This World, Small Wonder.
Small Wonder, yeah.
Elf, the Harry and the Henderson Show. And, you know, I don't think there was embedded context in them, but I think a lot of that was... I made this joke that if you took all those shows and replaced the magical character with a gay son... That's pretty much what the show is about for a lot of those things.
Right.
And so, I don't know. And they would try to make it as a kid's show.
And those shows seem to succeed in every generation.
We seem
to think that we're past that. Oh, we're sophisticated now. But all those shows you just rattled off in the 80s, 20 years after
it's
My Favorite
show.
Martian. And today, you know, you got your... I made a crack on Twitter a couple years ago where I dissed the guy who played Dennis on the Head of the Class.
Yes.
And I said, whatever happened to that guy?
He runs Nickelodeon.
And then, and then everybody tweeted me, oh, he's the most powerful man in Hollywood, you retard.
Yeah.
And I went, oh, I didn't know. He produces all those terrible Nickelodeon sitcoms with the world's worst laugh tracks.
Yep.
And they're extremely popular.
They are.
And so it's, again, it's like we're not that sophisticated. For some reason, that kind of style of what you think might be juvenile still manages to succeed immensely.
But it's almost more narrow-casted now because I think that, you know, families were probably watching My Favorite Martian together. Although, you know, there's the children's element, but it was certainly probably family viewing. And I think that in the 90s what happened was... the three-camera format became less about families and more about workplace sitcoms or things like Friends. And so the more traditional sitcoms instantly started narrow casting to teenage girls or tweens, which weren't a thing.
Right.
So they got more and more babyish. And you actually saw that on a lot of shows. Like I always use Punky Brewster as the example because that show started as an issues show. It was a dark issues show. I mean, it's not NYPD Blue, but it was a family dark issues show about, you know, child abuse. And they did some very heavy special episodes. But then when it got canceled on NBC and became a syndicated show, it's now a cartoon for babies, basically.
Right.
And you can tell by the audience laugh track because it's clearly an audience entirely of 9-year-olds.
They sound like kids.
And the humor is very juvenile all the time now for kids. And there's a few shows, different strokes of the same thing.
Definitely.
And they came back. They become more and more childish as they go along, which is an odd thing. And now they just kind of did away with the first 4 seasons.
Pretended it never happened.
Right. And now all the shows are that final season of those shows.
That's very interesting. There was a Punky Brewster cartoon as well, right?
It's Punky Brewster.
I remember that
vaguely.
Which
is very strange. I always theorized that someone had pitched this show about a magical elf. And the network said no, and then the guy just pulled out of his ass like, and the girl's Punky Brewster. And they're like, sold. Because there's nothing to do with Punky Brewster.
Well, there was a My Favorite Martian cartoon once. One ABC Saturday Morning Superstar special. Like a 90-minute animated My Favorite
Filmation?
Martian.
Was it Filmation? Filmation did a lot of the adaptions.
It may have been Filmation or Hanna-Barbera.
Right.
But I'm not sure which. It may even been Rankin Bass. All three companies animated for that ABC Superstar Saturday Morning movie in the early 70s. They did one that was a Bewitched one. Mm-hmm. They did one that was... Is Tabitha the spinoff of Bewitched?
Yes,
yeah,
Tabitha.
So they did one called Tabitha and the Clown Family, which is sort of a ripoff of Josie and the Pussycats with a bubblegum band, except the drummer is in clown makeup. And it's all
like
rotoscoped. It's terrifying.
Yeah.
It's terrifying. I think that one's Hanna-Barbera. But that one, it's got all the songs and, oh, my Lord.
There's a show from the 80s called Little Clowns of Happytown. Uh-huh. Have you ever seen that?
No.
It was on ABC, and it was produced by a producer who had cancer and was hanging out in the cancer wards, like the children's wards, and clowns come in and amuse the kids. So the guy goes, you know, let's do a cartoon about clowns that kind of help kids die, basically.
My God.
But not that dark, and it's really bizarre. Really bizarre.
How long did that last?
Not even a season. It was gone by mid-season.
Wow.
Yeah, really
bizarre.
Weird. So people are watching this stuff. There's really only three networks. They might have the local channels, and it's mostly family viewing, this issue from 63. Did you watch any stuff? Well, you didn't really get a lot of stuff, but did you watch things with your parents?
Not really. I mostly watched in my parents' basement to escape my parents, who were viciously fighting most of the time.
Right.
I'm trying to think. My dad mostly watched hockey.
Right.
Hockey Night in Canada, nobody's written the proper book about it. I tried to before I left Canada to write the oral history of Hockey Night in Canada. I had a book deal with Penguin Books. Fell through. HarperCollins picked up the ball, fell through again, mostly because of legal reasons. CBC did not want this sort of salacious tell-all. I simply just ripped off Tom Shales' Live from New York and applied it to this show, Hockey Night in Canada.
Right.
And it's hard to explain to an American audience how important Hockey Night in Canada was because there's no correlation. Like I would say,
it's not like Monday Night Football.
I would say Monday Night Football, but it's not. Literally, everybody in Canada watched Hockey Night in Canada because everybody got the same channel.
Right.
Only got one channel, and it started on radio in the 30s, shifted to TV in 1953. And remained on the air every Saturday during hockey season to this very day. So it's the longest running program in broadcast history, the second longest running TV show in TV history after Meet the Press and started in 48, Hockey Night in Canada on TV in 53, but it started on radio in 31.
Right.
It's still going.
Right.
And it had all these seminal, iconic things. The logo was iconic. The theme song was iconic. The uniforms that the broadcasters wore in the 60s, 70s, and 80s, and part of the 90s are iconic, and everybody in Canada knows that. So I watched that show with my father.
And if you want to commit a crime in Canada, do it during Hockey Night in Canada, and no one would...
Right.
You could do
right,
anything. You just
right,
walk into
right.
banks.
You could. You could. Spinner Spencer, who was a hockey player for the Toronto Maple Leafs, I think he did rob a bank at one
nice.
Point.
Nice. During a game. No one
I wish. He had a giant afro. The 70s are the best era if you want to watch hockey or Hockey Night in
That's
Canada.
That's true of all sports, because, I think.
Well, it was in hockey, it was before the rules changed where you had to wear a helmet.
Right.
So you could still have a giant afro and just be have it flowing in the wind as
Grow
you skate down
the helmet.
Yeah. And Spinner Spencer had one of the best white guy afros. Well, I don't have to qualify that. It's hockey. But yeah. He had this great afro. His father...
You look like the singer from the MC5. That's what I'm picturing.
Yes, definitely. This actually goes back to my concept of being isolated and watching TV. Spinner Spencer's father lived in, I think, Prince George, British Columbia, north in the woodlands where the caribou roam
okay.
can. And it's very isolated up there, too. He wanted to watch his son's game, like his debut with the
right.
Toronto Maple Leafs. But they weren't showing that game that night on his channel. They were showing a different hockey game.
Right.
So he went to the local TV station with a shotgun and demanded they switch the feed to the Toronto
but
feed so he
son.
Could watch his son. Yeah.
And I feel like hockey's so revered that the station was like, fair enough.
They actually made
charges.
They actually made a TV movie about Spinner Spencer, and this is all dramatized in the movie.
Really?
It was a made-for-TV movie on the CBC in Canada in the 90s. I remember watching it. It was great. It was the first movie directed by Adam McGoyan.
Okay.
Who is now a well-known indie director who did Exotica and all
right,
kinds
right,
of
right.
stuff. You know, contemporary of sorts of
yeah.
Cronenberg or that
right,
tradition.
Right, right, right.
Anyways, I don't know. That's what I mostly watched with my father was hockey.
Right. So your parents are probably like, why are you into all this weird old stuff?
They never noticed that I was right. into any of that old stuff.
Are you only child?
No, I had a brother. But my parents never noticed what I was into. My mom still
right.
doesn't know what I'm into.
Did you stay out of trouble?
Did I stay out
yeah,
of trouble?
Yeah.
Well, trouble's a subjective
well,
term.
Well, that's true. I mean, I was into all this stuff with my parents compared to my sister. I asked because my parents didn't care what I was doing because they didn't have to be involved because I wasn't in trouble, basically.
Oh, no. I mean, I sort of guess compared to my brother, I was in trouble. Because he didn't do anything. He just stayed in his room
right.
for 20 years.
Right.
And my mother dressed him until he was 30, I think. So,
excellent.
So the idea that I would dress myself at the age of 19 made me like quite a
radical.
Bad yes.
Yeah.
Exactly. I didn't get a high school diploma because I was kicked out of high school in the 11th grade. So maybe there's an argument to be made that I wasn't a good child.
Did you watch Degrassi?
Everybody watched Degrassi
yeah.
in Canada. Again, it was a CBC show.
This is all you had.
I remember
choice.
It from very early on. From
Kids of Degrassi Street?
Yes, I remember Kids of Degrassi Street in 1984. And I remember it very well because it was filmed so oddly. It was always kind of soft focus, foggy.
Yeah.
And it had this weird kind of like gentle piano score underneath it. So it had this weird vibe. And I remember Joey Jeremiah right from the very beginning because he always wore a hat and
yeah.
a vest. Right in Kids of Degrassi Street. But I didn't grow up in Toronto where the thing took
Still
place.
Still seems exotic.
Yeah, well, it didn't seem exotic. I just couldn't relate. I was like, what the fuck is this?
Right.
Like, why is it foggy?
Right.
Then I moved to Toronto. It wasn't foggy
Did
there.
You watch Buckshot when you were a kid? Was that in your area?
Never.
Okay.
What's Buckshot?
Buckshot. I did an episode with Ophira Eisenberg, who grew up, I think,
yeah,
in Western
Canada. Yeah, I know
Ophira,
sure.
And she said she used to watch the show Buckshot in Canada. That was just some, like, really bad cowboy puppet show in Canada that no one has ever heard of.
I was at Ophira Eisenberg's first stand-up taping. I knew her from Toronto stand-up, like, in 1999. We were on a lot of the same shows before she moved to America. I had completely lost contact with her. But I remember her doing her stand-up special, and that the guy who... They did three stand-up specials in a row. Thank you. They did three stand-up tapings in a row, and the guy who was keeping the audience warmed up in between each
yeah.
taping was getting way bigger laughs than the three people taping the shows.
Fear
is one of the people taping the specials, but the guy who was warming up the audience between each act was Russell Peters.
Oh, yeah.
But I never saw Buckshot.
Yeah.
Kids of Degrassi Street, sure. And then in Sex Education, in junior high, they showed us episodes of Degrassi Junior High.
Yes, the AIDS.
One, I don't know if they showed the AIDS one.
Teen
they showed
pregnancy.
The one. They showed the one where the guy has to carry the egg around and not
yes.
break it.
Egg baby.
Egg
yes.
baby. Yeah.
And I think it's Spike or someone gets pregnant.
Definitely Spike.
Yeah.
Definitely
yeah.
Spike.
So that show was very exotic to me because we were getting all this Canadian stuff. on PBS, which is what Degrassi aired on, and on Nickelodeon here, right. which was mostly Canadian content.
Did Nickelodeon also show You Can't Do That on Television?
It did.
Which is very Canadian as well.
Very Canadian. And they picked it up after the first season, which was a very different season with Ruth Buzzy.
Here's a piece of trivia, which nobody has ever told you and nobody ever will again.
Okay.
Les Sly, the yes. actor who played Barf. And most of the adult male characters. He got his start in a comedy team in Canada in 1963 with Rich Little.
Really?
Rich Little and Les Sly.
I didn't even know Rich Little was Canadian.
Yeah, of course, yeah. They were a comedy team in Ottawa in the early 60s.
I would say Les Sly is the talented one in that pair.
Yeah, but if Les Sly had lived longer and done more, maybe you would disagree.
That's true. Rich Little is one of those guys that we just got inundated with down here.
Yes.
And every single one of his impressions was Richard Nixon.
Yeah.
He said it was someone else.
You know, I was watching a YouTube clip of an impressionist named Guy Marks.
Yes.
You know who that is?
Yes.
He's in a bunch of sitcoms in the early 60s, the Joey Bishop sitcom, and I think he's in a Western called Rango with
right.
Tim Conway. He did a spot on the Perry Como show, I think. I watched it on YouTube. It's excellent, but he does all the hack impressions. He does
yeah.
Bogart, Cagney, Boris Karloff. These were the hack.
Ed Sullivan.
He didn't do Sullivan, but it was that kind of thing.
Yeah.
And, you know, the equivalent of a Christopher Walken impression today or
right.
a Jack Nicholson impression in the 80s. But he does them better than anybody I'd ever seen in my life. It was
right.
eerie how good they were. And I wondered if maybe he was the guy who invented them because they're so good.
Yeah, people are doing an impression of his impression.
Yes, and Rich Little kind of just did impressions of other people's impressions.
Yes, yeah, absolutely.
Adeptly, but they were all kind of ones that had already been done.
Yes.
And yet he continued to... Do you remember the TV movie? Of course you do.
Rich Little's Christmas?
No, The Late Shift.
Yes.
Of Bill Carter's Late Shift.
Yes.
And they got Rich Little to do Carson.
Yes.
And he can do the voice, but they put him in a white wig. And it looks
it
like
work.
Rich Little.
Yeah,
he's got a big fat head.
It's like albino Rich Little.
Oh, my God. I mean, it takes you right out of the movie.
It absolutely does. He hasn't... Is he still alive?
Rich Little's still alive. He lives in Las Vegas.
You don't see him.
His son or his daughter drowned maybe 5 years ago, so he was laying low, and his wife died around the same time. Had lots of tragedy. Remarried. He is good friends with John Voight.
Yes.
And I was at a screening of Midnight Cowboy here in town about 5 years ago, and it was going to be introduced by John Voight, and John Voight starts talking about Obama. Complaining about whatever, and then
right.
he invites his very special friend up from the audience, and it's Rich Little.
And they just go on a right-wing
Rich
rant.
Little and John Voight did 50 minutes of right-wing anti-Obama jokes before a screen of Midnight Cowboy. Failed to mention Midnight Cowboy.
Yeah. For some reason, I'm Facebook friends with Arch Hall Jr.
Arch Hall Jr., of course, yeah,
and
the Choppers.
Exactly.
Ega.
He posts the craziest right-wing rants ever. It's fantastic.
Well, he doesn't seem like the kind of guy that would have been was ever intelligent to begin with. As much
no.
as we love him
no.
and love his filmography,
Wild Guitar,
which takes place right down the street
Absolutely.
Here, Capitol Records building, the
yep.
Walk of Fame. First time I ever came to Los Angeles, the theme music to Wild Guitar came on my iPod as I was walking down Vine Street past the Capitol Records.
And you were like, "I'm staying."
Yeah, Wild Guitar.
So, what brought you here for the first time?
As an adult, and I think it was the same year as that John Voight screening. It was for the Turner Classic Movies Film Festival. I saw the ads in Canada and wanted to go, but it was very expensive.
Yeah.
And my girlfriend at the time suggested that I apply for a press pass to cover it for WFMU, so
smart
I did.
Girl.
Very smart girl.
You were already writing these articles.
I had already written a popular article about David Letterman and Woody Allen for WFMU.
And the Joey Ross one, I think, is the first thing I remember.
Oh, yeah, sure. That was a very popular one. So I decided to cover that for the TCM Festival for them, came to Los Angeles and realized that...
it's amazing.
Everything is here. Everything I've ever enjoyed is from here. Music, movies,
yeah.
television, art. Anybody I've ever admired comes through here if they
right.
don't live here. I went for a little walk in between movies up Sunset Boulevard and paid homage to the Bullwinkle statue,
yes.
which has since
which
been removed.
Now.
But... blew my mind that it was still
there
at all.
Yeah.
Why would it still be there?
And the Myra Breckinridge spinning
yes.
woman used to be across the street, but is not. It was gone by the time I got here.
Right, right. And they used to paint over the Bullwinkle statue with a different... Thank you. They used to paint over the Bullwinkle statue with a different fashion, like a different style swimsuit, to correspond with the billboard that was across. Yeah. Well, they had a billboard for some swimsuit line across the street, and it would change the fashion on it every few months. So whenever they did that, they repaint the Bullwinkle statue in the new
I'd like to talk to the guy who did that job.
Yes, yeah. Jay Ward was very influential on my thinking. They used to show... Yeah. One of the great TV stations of my youth in Canada was called YTV, Youth Television. It was like a Canadian Nickelodeon.
Yeah, but they brought that up.
But they reran a lot of stuff late at night. And on weeknights, I'd watch it during the summer break when I was off from school. At 2 in the morning, they'd show it Get Smart. And at 2:30, they'd show Rocky and Bullwinkle.
Which is a great pairing.
Great pairing. And in fact, it's one of the things that got me interested in comedy writers. In the credits, there was the same name in both shows, a guy named Chris Hayward, who was a showrunner on Barney Miller and the Munsters, and clearly must have been a very funny man if he's credited on both Rocky and Bullwinkle and Get Smart, which are two of the hippest shows, which is not saying much, but two of the hippest shows in the 1960s.
They managed to be reflective about culture, which was pretty new at the time. And actually, for someone who loves Cracked and Mad Magazine, seems to fit.
Right.
But without being snarky.
Yeah.
Like, pardon me, I'm having a big...
You could enjoy it on multiple levels. Yeah. Like, you didn't have to be hip to laugh at it. You could be 6 years old and love both, or you could be a grown man with a university education.
Like, I remember the Fractured Fairy Tales, for example.
Sure.
Those were sort of twisted takes on fairy tales, but ended up reinforcing the point of the fairy tale better than sometimes the original tale.
Right, there was a moral.
Yeah.
A not heavy-handed moral.
Exactly.
To it.
And so it was brilliant.
And great voice actors. You know, I remember one of the first comedy records I ever bought when I was a teenager was this record, Stan Freberg with the original cast. And I listened to it, and I loved it because I recognized all the voices. But
it's
all the
Hanna-Barbera.
I didn't know why I recognized the voices, and I realized that two of the voices were the voices of Fractured Fairy Tales, Dawes Butler and June Foray, who were both on Rocky and Bullwinkle, I think, uncredited, or at least Dawes Butler
June Foray was Rocky.
She was Rocky the Flying Squirrel and Natasha, and she was the voice of every woman on that series. So there was lots of, you know, princesses in Fractured Fairy Tales.
Did you see the Boris and Natasha movie with Dave Thomas?
I never saw it, but Brent Butt, who's the most successful Canadian stand-up comic, who has the only successful Canadian sitcom of all time, Corner Gas, is in that movie.
What about King of Kensington?
King of Kensington, well, comparatively speaking, it was the only successful Canadian sitcom for so long, but now Corner Gas has so eclipsed it and is so 1,000 times more successful that now King of Kensington seems unsuccessful.
Really, really.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Keep in mind that in the 70s we had one channel.
Right.
You know, or two. We had one channel that showed new episodes of King of Kensington and another channel that showed the reruns of King of Kensington.
Because that was on for like 10 years or something, right?
I don't think it was on that long. I think it was on more like 6 or 7 seasons.
I always think of it as...
But if you go to Kensington Market in Toronto, where that TV show took place, hypothetically, there is a statue in the park of Al Waxman, the King of Kensington. Furthermore, if you go to ACTRA, which is the Canadian version of SAG, that head office has a giant oil painting of Al Waxman, like within a robe that overlooks the whole office.
People in the States would have no idea who that is. Just like,
he was the desk sergeant on Cagney and Lacey. That was his only claim to fame in America, and he was in the Louis Malle film Atlantic City.
It's like I look at it as like thank you very much. It's like the British equivalent would be Only Fools and Horses is the way that people look at.
I'm not familiar.
The way that Canadians sort of think of King of Kensington, I find that.
There's an episode, though, I never forgot, that Hervé Velichez is in.
Yes.
And he jumps on the back in a grocery store on Al Waxman, as I recall. Big laughs from the studio audience on that one.
People love a little person.
And, of course, Mike Myers, child actor Mike Myers, before he was Wayne Campbell on SNL, is in, I think, two episodes of King of Kensington.
And I found out about King of Kensington from Twitch City.
Oh, sure.
Which was kind of my introduction.
They referenced it a lot.
He plays the King of Kensington in the first episode.
Oh, that's hilarious.
And is murdered.
That's hilarious.
In Kensington Market.
I have to go back and watch
Great
Twitch City. Yeah. It didn't last. It had a lot of push behind it because it featured,
Don McKellar.
Don McKellar and Bruce McCullough.
Yes.
Who, the kids in the hall, when I was growing up, and still to this day, are one of the biggest things in Canada, and certainly one of... It's unfair for me to say the biggest, but I think I could make a reasoned argument that they were the biggest thing in the history of Canadian comedy. That's a bold statement for people who grew up on SCTV and the Second City Saturday Night Live connection. But for my generation, nobody was bigger than the Kids in the Hall. They only ever had a cult following, really, here, a big one. Mm-hmm. But in Canada, they were mainstream.
Yeah.
That comedy was mainstream in Canada in the late 80s and throughout the 90s. And the biggest thing, the next day in school after a new episode of Kids in the Hall, it's all anybody talked about. And to this day, all five of those guys have carte blanche to do whatever they want in Canada.
Absolutely. And I love SCTV. It's maybe my favorite sketch show of all time. I think it's infinitely better than Saturday Night Live. But despite the Bob and Doug McKenzie thing, it was not an overtly Canadian show. It pretended to not be Canadian a lot. Some probably by design on the NBC seasons, but not so much earlier from what we got down here. But Kids in the Hall was unapologetically Canadian.
Right.
You knew it was a Canadian show.
Right. I just knew it was a hilarious show. And up to that point, no Canadian comedy I'd ever been exposed to was hilarious. In fact, I don't know, like, it's all objective, but I don't know that I had seen a Canadian comedy that I had found funny at that point. I had certainly seen John Candy movies and thought they were hilarious, but I mean, like, something that originated in Canada. We had a horrific show that I used to reference in my stand-up act just as an easy referential laugh, you know? I was an amateur comic at the time, and it was an easy referential laugh. Was this show called Smith & Smith.
Okay.
And it was also known as the Smith & Smith Comedy Mill in a different season.
Variety show or a sketch show?
It was a sketch show that was not funny. It was very broad, and it was interspersed with gospel songs that were not jokes in the middle.
So it's like Canadian Hee Haw.
I don't think that there's anything I can compare it to, but the guy who created it and starred in it, Steve Smith, you would know, being a TV junkie.
Yep.
He created the character on that sketch show, which 15 years later became the most successful syndicated Canadian program of all time, despite not being good.
Red Green Show?
Red Green Show.
Yeah.
So Red Green was invented for this show, Smith & Smith, and Red Green, Steve Smith, was Smith in Smith & Smith Comedy Mill. So that show started in the late 70s, and it aired all through the 80s. Nobody liked it. Nobody ever liked
it. But it was an institution.
It wasn't even an institution. It was just like, oh, what the fuck? Why is this on again? You know? And some people remember it and some don't. If most Canadians, if they saw a clip of it, would remember. But it was so bad that very few people retained the name of it even.
They blocked it out for their own sanity.
I used to do this joke on stage. I'd say I used to write for the Smith & Smith Comedy Mill. And maybe a third of the audience would laugh. But that third would laugh really hard.
Right.
And then the other two-thirds
wouldn't
know. I
also remember Bizarre at that time.
Bizarre was a co-production, Canada and America. It aired on Showtime here, and they showed topless nudity on the Showtime version. In Canada, there was no topless nudity.
They'd reshoot the same sketch with toplessness.
Right.
It was so bizarre.
Right. John Biner was American. Bob Einstein was American. But there was a tax break incentive in the 70s, Canada tax shelter incentive. And they came up to Toronto to shoot it, and that's where Super Dave Osborne was invented, was for that show. And YTV, who, when I was saying they used to rerun Rocky and Bullwinkle and Get Smart, they also reran Bizarre at midnight on Fridays in the 90s.
The continental version or the Canadian version?
The Canadian version. It was a children's channel, YTV. So it was, you know, their late night
thing.
But they also showed The Young Ones, the British show.
We got that in MTV here.
Yeah, Yes, Prime Minister. This was a children's channel. They're showing this stuff.
That's a pretty good education.
They would show great movies on Sundays. I remember seeing Lord Love a Duck starring Roddy McDowell.
Yes, in a Tuesday Weld.
Yeah, Tuesday Weld with that pervy scene in the mink clothing store.
What a weird movie that is.
Yeah, it's a fun movie, a great Neil Hefti soundtrack. Well, it's written by George Axelrod, the great George Axelrod, who wrote 7 Year Itch and Will Success Spoil Rock Hunter, a lot of great plays and movies. Anyways, YTV was incredible in terms of their programming. It was pretty mishmash, but they showed Bizarre reruns.
Bizarre was like...
Literally, both Bizarre reruns and reruns of Bizarre, yeah.
Bizarre reminded me, it was almost like a Canadian Benny Hill.
Was sort of like that. I never found Bizarre funny. I loved the theme song. Super Dave Osborne also was a co-Canadian American production. It reran ad nauseum, probably still does rerun ad nauseum in Canada today as a Canadian content thing. I never enjoyed it. I never liked the laugh track. I always liked Bob Einstein, but I never liked the Super Dave show.
There was another Canadian producer from in the 80s that I used to watch a lot. Speaking of Get Smart, which is a show called Check It Out.
Of course, yeah.
And that aired on USA Network here, but was very Canadian.
Yeah, well, it was created for CTV in Canada. Again, that secondary network that I'm talking about. Check It Out was one of many attempts to recreate the success of King of Kensington.
Right.
All through the 80s and 90s, there were Canadian sitcoms, but none lasted more than a season. Check It Out ran for three seasons. It starred Don Adams from Get Smart
as
with a mustache.
As the manager of a supermarket.
As a manager of a supermarket in Calgary, not even Toronto, in Western Canada, all just terribly contrived. It looked like it was shot on videotape.
It was, yeah.
With like
very
a
cheap
like,
show.
And the interesting thing about it, the reason Don Adams is in it, you know, this sort of star, at least people still remember
people
him from Get Smart.
From Tennessee Tuxedo.
And Tennessee Tuxedo. there was nobody else in the film or in the TV show that was of note or famous.
Right.
But the reason Don Adams accepted this gig to star in a terrible Canadian sitcom was because he was a terrible gambling addict.
Right.
And so he took that gig in Canada strictly to pay down his debts.
Phil Silver style.
Yeah, exactly. Every single... that's the reason that show apparently went to third season. Because Don Adams had not paid off his gambling debts.
Because of the ponies.
The debts he owed were to the mafia.
Yeah.
So it was quite imperative that he pay off these debts.
Would you say the worst thing the mafia ever did was give us a third season of Check It Out?
Yeah, it's right up there.
Yeah.
It's right up there. But I watched it. I watched it every week on CTV at my grandma's house. That was, again, that dark pre-cable era in my life where you just watched whatever was on. Bizarre. Check It Out. I'm trying to think of Smith & Smith Comedy Mill. I don't know if it's on YouTube, but it's truly terrible. But it had gospel songs that weren't comedy in between the sketches. And I once asked Steve Smith, Red Green, when I met him, I said, you know, Smith & Smith Comedy Mill, you guys sung on it. Why?
Yeah.
And he didn't have a funny answer, but he did talk in this voice.
Remember
and he said,
you.
Well, at that time, the Canadian Television Awards, they didn't have a comedy category, just a variety. And so in order to have variety, we had to have a musical component. But that guy's the wealthiest man in the history of Canadian television. Lives in Hamilton in some...
He owns Hamilton.
Yeah.
Well, it's like the Young Ones story where the reason they had musical guests on, which I'm sure you've heard, was that they got a bigger budget as a musical variety show.
Right.
So it was a sitcom that just Madness was on, The Damned. Every episode they'd have a musical act completely with no context whatsoever in this sitcom because they got extra money.
Well, that's cool. But they could also get away with it because anything could be out of context in The Young Ones.
There was no context. An
Alexei Sale monologue, the subliminal flickers, you know.
That show changed my life.
I loved The Young Ones, and when I used to have hair, I used to grow my red hair up to kind of mimic Vivian. Yeah, Ade Edmondson.
Is that why you spent that time in jail for abusing people violently?
Did he really go to jail?
No, but it's such a violent character.
Yeah.
And he's
the sweetest guy. Hippie!
Yeah.
Kicking the hallway in. You know, all those British comics from that era ended up writing novels. I remember reading Hugh Laurie's novel before he was known in America. PBS from Spokane, when we got cable, they were showing a bit of Fry and Laurie in 1992. I became addicted to it. I became the biggest Stephen Fry fan in the world. I bought a copy of The Hippopotamus. I bought a copy of The Liar. And then I guess Hugh Laurie tried to follow in his footsteps, and he wrote one novel. Stephen Fry wrote many novels, and his first one is probably his best, The Liar. But Hugh Laurie wrote a book called The Gunseller, and it's got the best opening three paragraphs of any novel I've ever read of that era, and then the rest of the book is
downhill.
Shit. Yeah.
I was really into Red Dwarf at that time from New Hampshire PBS.
Right.
We would get that. It would air in a block with Red Green and Red Dwarf, which I think someone at that PBS station didn't watch the shows but was like, Red and Red, perfect.
Right.
Makes perfect sense.
Right.
very, very weird.
That's very funny.
So we didn't get too much into this issue here, but how did you start to...
Let's get into the issue.
How did you start to hunt down some of these shows? Because movies, yes, we have video stores, we can find movies.
Right.
It was a little harder when we were teenagers. I remember taking, you know, two buses and a train to get a copy of Eraserhead.
Right.
But TV shows, if they weren't airing, you could read about them, but there was really absolutely no way to get them.
I am a real fraud. I'm a YouTube baby. I really am. As soon as YouTube came out, don't even know the year, but I was one of the first people to like discover YouTube. I think I would send the link. I was like, "Have you looked at this website?" And watched every Ernie and Bert Sesame Street sketch from the 70s on YouTube. It was the first thing I ever watched. And just hunted everything down, and still do over the course of the past few years. And people think I'm much older than I am when they meet me, because I know about Gary Moore.
Right.
I've seen every episode of I've Got a Secret and What's My Line. But it's strictly because of YouTube. I didn't catch any of this.
You use the most modern technology to seem really old.
Yeah, isn't that interesting? And same with research, too.
Right.
Like, I mean, how did anybody research history without the internet? I don't know.
Well,
I would never have been able to be one of those guys in the 70s who goes to the stacks or the microfiche and research things. I don't have the disposition for that. I like just doing it in my in my underwear at home between porn sites. It's so much easier.
You can do that at the library too. It's just a different issue.
Yeah. Not in the 70s.
Right. But I was going to the microfiche, and I would get the movie the old Grindhouse movie listings, and I'd have to pay to get a printout and all that stuff. It's ridiculous.
I always had a general knowledge for some reason that these things existed. Like, I kind of always had an understanding of who Steve Allen was. Who Jack Parr was, even though I had not seen them. I don't know where that came from. I picked it up, I guess, from Mad Magazine spoofs and things like that. I had a good tactile mind for absorbing that information. But it was really the internet that accelerated everything for me as like an eventual expert.
When did you start interviewing these people?
I started interviewing old comedians. I did a zine when I was still doing stand-up. In 2003, I briefly did a photocopied zine. The zine boom is already over, but I decided to do it and defy the internet. And I was collecting records. All through my teenage years, I was collecting LPs. And I would collect comedy records. And every thrift store in America and Canada has records by three comedians that nobody is familiar with.
Yep.
Woody Woodbury, Rusty Warren, and Von Meter. These three are in every thrift store, every junk store, every pawn shop, but are not household names. How could they not be household names if they're in every store, the most common records? And I was like, well, who are they? Why are they? So I managed to track down Woody Woodbury somehow. With the internet. And interviewed him about his career. And it was very good. And people said, oh, you should do more of that. And I never did.
Right.
And then 3 years later, I was writing for WFMU online, and I wrote this piece, or started to, about this guy named Murray Roman, very obscure comedian who was kind of like a poor man's Lenny Bruce.
Right.
As Fred Willard would maybe describe it this past weekend, he'd be Lenny Bruce after taxes. Murray Roman was just the poor man's Lenny Bruce, but he put out this bizarre comedy record I was so fascinated by. It was like psychedelic, it had a kaleidoscopic cover, and he would deliver his punchlines, and it would echo with reverb, like psychedelic reverb at the end of the jokes. And I was like, this is so weird. Tommy Smothers from the Smothers Brothers wrote the liner notes.
Right.
So I asked him, who is this guy, Murray Roman? And he started telling me the whole story. This was at a show. So a few months later, I followed up and contacted Tommy Smothers. I said, I want to write a piece about this guy, Murray Roman. Can I interview you? We spoke, but at the end of the phone conversation, he said, you know who would know more about this than me is Steve. Have you talked to Steve yet? And I go, Steve? He goes, Steve Martin.
Yeah, because he used to write for him.
He used to write for the Smothers Brothers, and so did Murray Roman. 2 hours later, my phone rings in Vancouver, my shitty apartment, and it's Steve Martin on the line. So that was the start of interviewing these guys.
Yeah.
The first guy was Woody Woodbury. Several years later, the second guy was Tommy Smothers. A couple hours later,
Steve Martin.
So I kept that because original research is better than relying on pre-existing research.
Absolutely.
You get the new stories out of people. So I started that around 2006 and only really picked up my pace with it around 2009, 2010.
Right.
And discovered that there's this whole circuit of comedy in the 40s and 50s that is undocumented.
Right.
There are lots of books about vaudeville. There are books about the comedy club age.
Right.
There's no books about comedy specifically in the 40s and 50s when the mafia controlled nightclubs.
Right.
And I thought that was really intriguing.
And
so
a lot of those
that's
guys,
kind of what I've been studying.
A lot of those mafia comics showed up on television.
Sure.
They were the character actors on television.
That was
almost the feeder into that world for a lot of the
things. Definitely. Well, there was also a genre that is long lost, but in the late 40s, throughout the 1940s, if you were a sketch comedian,
right.
it wasn't on radio, and it wasn't in vaudeville, and right. it wasn't in nightclubs, it was on Broadway,
right.
and it was what they called the review, spelled specifically R-E-V-U-E.
Right.
So if you ever see review R-E-V-U-E, it's often misspelled.
Right.
That specifically referred to sketch comedy.
Which would have been like Hell's a Poppins, probably
yes,
the most famous.
Yes, exactly, on Broadway. And all the actors that did that, they were not necessarily nightclub comedians, somewhere and somewhere, but they were everybody that populated the shows like
right.
The Honeymooners
right.
and Milton Berle's variety shows, and then all the sitcoms in the 50s and 60s. 9 out of 10 of those guys were guys that worked in these sketch right. comedy reviews right. in the 40s. Anyways, this was an entire undocumented era, as far as I could tell, at least
right.
not properly done. So I decided to zero in on that. You
right.
know, it's always good to find a niche that other people aren't always
right.
also doing. You know, so.
So, the interesting thing to me about, you know, you obviously have some cachet now in that world,
yes,
and you have access to
gratefully.
Things that you would never have had access to in Canada, I
yes.
imagine, even
yes.
with YouTube.
Yes.
So there are probably shows like in this TV guide that you could get a hold of, or that
right.
you know people who can get you archives and
right.
things.
Right.
Do you take advantage of that?
I really don't. You know, UCLA has a great film and television archive, but you have to set up appointments.
Right.
Often you have to prove why you're doing it,
right.
like that you have credentials. There's, of course, the Paley Center Television Academy, which I had a membership to, and I went once, and it
right.
cost me a couple $100 and expired by the end of the year. But I have gone there from time to time. Right now in this TV guide, we're looking at this great ad for Steve Allen, 11:15 p.m. weeknights.
Zing!
Zing! Exclamation point.
He's on the phone.
KDKA TV2. This is the syndicated Westinghouse Steve Allen show. There
right.
were so many different versions of the Steve Allen show, all called the Steve Allen show. But this 60s one, I guess he had two syndicated ones, first half of the 60s and the last half of the 60s. Oh, maybe three, actually, now that I think of it. The late 60s one features the TV debuts, plural, of Albert Brooks, and you can watch some of those at the TV Academy,
right.
and I did go and watch some of that.
It's very weird, too, that because television was disposable, especially
right.
at that time, you would get the history of like 50s to even 70s shows for these people that were around all the time is a little bit difficult to parse out, because you get the Steve Allen show, the new Steve Allen show,
right.
the Steve Allen show.
Well, in TV, the thing is, if you were to look at this TV guide right now, at 12 o'clock, the listing says Johnny Carson,
right.
which was never the name of the show.
Right. And that's not the Tonight Show.
It is the Tonight Show.
Is it the Tonight Show?
That is the Tonight Show.
63, he was doing Tonight Show?
Yes, that's the first, he'd been doing it for a year.
So it's the 4th, November 4th, 1963, and you know, you're pointing out that they're calling it Carson, they're not calling it the Tonight Show.
Yeah, in TV Guide, it's listed as Johnny Carson, and then there's also things that just say Steve Allen. But
right.
that was not actually the name of the show. Same thing in these early... In the 50s and 60s, there's listings in TV Guide that just says cartoons.
Right.
Children. Who
yeah.
knows what it was? Heckle
yeah.
and Jekyll, Bugs Bunny, who knows?
Because these were made locally, and, you know, they weren't. There wasn't necessarily the sort of corporate branding where they would say, if you list this show, you have to call it The Tonight
right.
Show. It was kind of like whatever the guy in the local office called the show.
It's difficult for historians, especially if they're not doing their work. When it comes to Steve Allen, Jack Parr, and Johnny Carson, the first three hosts of The Tonight Show, the show had shifted names. So originally, before The Tonight Show went national in 1954, I think, it was just regional in New York, and it was hosted
right.
by Steve Allen on WNBT, which became WNBC. It was called The Steve Allen Show regionally, and then it was called The Knickerbocker Beer Show because
right.
it was sponsored by Knickerbocker Beer.
I would hope that's why it was called
yes.
that.
Yes. And then when it went coast to coast, it became Tonight with an exclamation point.
Right.
It wasn't The Tonight Show. Then it eventually became The Tonight Show with Steve Allen. But then in the TV guide, it would still say things like Steve Allen.
Right.
With no more. Or it would say the Steve Allen Show when it wasn't called that.
It wasn't even called that.
Then in 1956, when Steve Allen went to Sunday nights, he was still hosting the Tonight Show part-time. His new show was called the Steve Allen Show.
Right, right.
So it becomes very confusing. Then Jack Parr takes over, and it's called The Tonight Show with Jack Parr. Again, the TV Guide listing just as Jack Parr.
Because people didn't need to fact check. I mean, they weren't making TV Guide specifically as a historical record.
And then sometimes it would say Jack Parr Show, which was the name of a show Jack Parr had before he had The Tonight Show, called The Jack Parr Show. And then Steve Allen had a syndicated show in the early 60s that was called The Steve Allen Show. Then he had another syndicated show called The Steve Allen Show.
Well, it's like, Phil Silvers is one of my all-time favorites, and Sergeant Bilko is called The Phil Silver Show.
Right.
It's not Sergeant Bilko.
Right.
It's The Phil Silver Show, but sometimes it would be listed in the TV Guide as Sergeant Bilko.
Right, and it was renamed The Phil Silver Show for syndication when it originally aired. It was called
You'll Never Get Rich. Right, and then there was the new Phil Silver Show.
But you're right. We're looking at a listing right now in TV Guide that says Bilko, capital letters.
Not even Sergeant Bilko.
Yeah, just Bilko.
Just Bilko.
Hyphenated Phil Silvers.
Which is one of my all-time favorite shows.
Sure,
and
of course.
This particular issue, I've noticed the original owner has made some notes in the margins about what they would watch.
See, he didn't want to watch Bilko, but at the same time, he did want to watch Sea Hunt.
Yes, and To Tell the Truth.
So all at the same time on 7 p.m. on November 4th, 63.
Which is Saturday evening.
Which is that shortly before or a year after the president was assassinated?
August 5th, 1962 was Maryland, so November, a year after.
So at the same time, 7 p.m., a year after the president was killed, you could watch a show called Hollywood and the Stars about Al Jolson. That sounds good.
And Focus on Behavior.
Focus on Behavior. Oh,
Channel
my God.
13.
No two alike. Lloyd Humphreys, University of Illinois, and James Gallagher, Institute for Research on Exceptional Children, show how they are developing new methods of measuring human capabilities. John G. Darley is host. Well, it's no coincidence that the original owner has not marked that down as something to watch.
No, does not want to watch that.
There's an episode of the Thin Man TV series. There's an episode of Mr. Ed, Huckleberry Hound, which I would probably watch.
What's your stance on Mr. Ed? Again, one of those magical things you have to keep a secret shows.
I never liked Mr. Ed.
I don't either.
I've watched the weird ones, like the Mae West episode.
Right.
And the episode where Mr. Ed becomes a beatnik. But it actually has the exact same laugh track as My Favorite Martian, literally.
Right.
You can recognize she's called the uh-oh woman.
Right.
Do you know about that?
Yes.
Where she shows up in all these sitcoms, it's the most distinctive mark on the laugh track. That's how you know they're using the same laugh track. Because right as the laughter tapers out, you hear this woman go, uh-oh.
Yeah.
And it's in Mr. Ed, it's in My Favorite Martian. I never really liked Mr. Ed, but the guy who starred as Wilbur, Alan Young, has a deep history that nobody knows about.
Right.
Unfortunately, there's things that will end up on our tombstones. Bobcat Goldthwait talks about it. Doesn't matter how many great indie movies he makes.
Hot to Trot.
It's gonna. He's gonna have the Police Academy burden on him for the rest of his life.
3 weeks of work when he was 23.
Right. So Alan Young, the same thing with Mr. Ed. Before he did Mr. Ed, he had this entire career. Almost 20 years, maybe 15. He started in Canada on CBC Radio. He was Canada's first star comedian. Nobody knows this.
I didn't know that. I didn't even know he's Canadian.
He's Canadian. He started in Vancouver. Toronto courted him. He had his own show called The Alan Young Show. It was a comedy show before Wayne and Schuster existed on CBC Radio. Eddie Cantor's manager picked up the CBC from New York one night and heard the show, thought it was funny, hired him as the summer replacement for the Eddie Cantor radio show on NBC in 1939. In fact, Alan Young, Wilbur, is still alive. He lives up on the hill.
Is he really? He's going to be in his 90s,
He's 95. Yeah, he lives in the motion picture home. But so he did this radio show on NBC, a summer replacement. You'll really find this interesting, actually. Throughout the 1940s, Cantor summer replacement. He'd never been to New York before. He gets all these New York Jewish comedy writers assigned to him doing jokes about bagel and lox.
Yeah, he's just some Canadian guy.
Scottish goyim from Vancouver.
He looks a bit like Ed Wood.
But one of the first writers on that show was Sherwood Schwartz.
Right.
In one of his first gigs. the creator of Brady Bunch and Gilligan's Island, the guy who wrote the theme song and was the band leader on the Alan Young radio show, while Sherwood Schwartz was the writer, was a guy named George Wyle, W-Y-L-E. He wrote the theme song to Gilligan's Island.
Yes.
So Sherwood Schwartz was on that show working. George Wyle, who wrote the Gilligan's Island theme song, was the band leader. One of the character actors on the Alan Young radio show, doing a character named Rupert Updike III,
okay.
A wealthy, rich snob.
I guess I wonder
Jim
who played that. Bacchus.
Yeah. Doing Thurston Howell III 20 years earlier on the Alan Young radio
show. Interesting.
So, anyways, that was Alan Young's career before he was on Mr. Ed. This radio show was critically acclaimed. It was pretty funny. It had a lot of great character actors. Hans Conried is in it. Arnold Stang is in it. And it lasted for several years. Then when TV came in the late 40s, one of the very first comedy shows done from the West Coast was the Alan Young Show.
Right.
It was the first comedy show to win an Emmy.
Right.
Nobody remembers this. And in fact, it also won a Peabody Award as like a intelligent
just
comedy.
Just really quality.
Yeah.
And then it's Mr. Ed.
But he's only known as Wilbur from Mr. Ed.
I always wonder how much of television history, sort of pre-1980, was dictated by chance. And what I mean to say is that not all shows were kinescoped.
Right.
Not all shows were saved.
Right.
Just some were. And the ones that weren't necessarily the best shows.
Right.
They just happened to get saved or survived for whatever reason.
Right.
And so those are the people who go, oh, classic shows like Mr. Ed. And it's like, there's probably five other better shows that you'll never see.
Right. And not only that, the internet has proved who was a liar who wrote books in the 70s. There's the guy who produced What's My Line for Goodson Todman. Not Goodson or Todman, but this other guy. He wrote a book about the show in the 70s where he says this happened and that happened and this person stumbled over the lines and this person fell down.
Yeah,
and now Game Show Network has rerun them and they're all on YouTube. You watch it and they completely contradict this guy's stories.
Unlike in the butt from the Newlywed Game, which is an actual clip.
Right. I love game show depravity.
Yes.
There's actually a nice little clip reel somebody put together on YouTube of some of the weird moments from What's My Line. And I don't know if you ever watched What's My Line, but I love the chemistry of the panel. Henry Morgan is one of my favorite comedians in the 40s and 50s. He's a sardonic, witty, sarcastic, not to be confused with Harry Morgan.
Not Harry Morgan of Black's Magic.
Yeah, but Henry Morgan, the funny satirist, had a very sardonic wit. And Bennett Cerf, who was another panelist on What's My Line, he was a publisher at Random House, fancied himself a comedian, but he wasn't funny.
No.
He wasn't funny. He was corny. He was like somebody's uncle doing dad jokes.
Dad jokes.
So on this one episode of What's My Line, it's his turn. He has to introduce the host. And he's doing it in this long, loquacious manner. He goes, our moderator, John Charles Daly, was recently up in the Poconos. And when the butler came in, Henry Morgan cuts him off and goes, how long is this story going to go on? And Bennett Cerf gets all flustered. He goes, Henry, may I finish? And Henry Morgan goes, I wish you would. It's this great moment of live television.
Yeah,
people
like
didn't treat themselves that way
on
50s TV. It was very polite.
Yes, very polite and congenial. And it was like you dress up. It was like we go on an airplane, we dress up. Yeah, there wasn't a lot of arguments.
There's another clip on that same clip reel of What's My Line kind of weird moments where a guy charges the stage. And What's My Line, if your listeners remember, there was a mystery guest segment where they put on blindfolds.
Yes.
There's this one segment where everybody puts on their blindfolds, and while they're blindfolded, a man from the audience charges the stage and tries to take over the show.
Yeah.
They drop off the sound because it was live TV, so people couldn't hear what he was saying. He was like yelling something at the camera, and you see these like security guards come on stage and lead him off.
Right.
And everybody's blindfolded and confused about what's going on. It's another really weird moment. Yeah. I don't know. Outtakes are fascinating to me.
Especially at that time, too, because it was, people hadn't learned how television worked on either side of the camera, really, that much.
People weren't as hip about show business.
Right, absolutely. Yeah. So when you would get, like, a loony showing up on the show, they kind of went above and beyond to know how to do that.
Well, looking at this TV guide, again, still at 7 o'clock, or coming up on 7:30, one of the things that this TV Guide owner has decided to watch is To Tell the Truth.
Yes.
Which, look at this, it's on channel 2, 9, 10, 12, 27, and 56 simultaneously.
Yes. Yeah, so it was regional. The TV guides would often be in a larger region than the networks were. So right. you would have like 9 ABC affiliates all airing, all under the same TV guide in a certain region.
Right.
Before they got really different, you know, different.
And early in those days, there were also independent TV stations that were corresponding affiliates from more than one network.
Right.
Where they'd show half CBS shows and half NBC
Which
shows.
Which people could not believe today.
Yeah, isn't that bizarre? Yeah. Like, I didn't even know that until fairly
recently.
They're
almost like insurance brokers. Yeah. Like, I can get you this company or this company.
Right.
Yeah. Whatever you like.
So they're showing To Tell the Truth, which is produced by the same people who produced What's My Line.
Similar show.
And I've got a secret. Four people on the panel, they're supposed to have a good chemistry. To Tell the Truth was very famous, parodied up the wazoo in Mad Magazine
Absolutely.
And things like that. Will the real so-and-so please stand
yes,
up?
Yes, yes.
Hosted by this guy, Bud Collier, who was a born-again Christian. He was the voice of Superman on radio in the 40s.
Which introduced Kryptonite and Jimmy Olsen, I think, on that
really?
Radio show. Yeah.
Kryptonite's not from the comic?
It was not from the comic.
I did not know that.
And I believe that the flying was from the TV series and not from the comic as well. He was just able to leap very high.
Oh, really? Yes. As I recall, the Superman radio show starts off with the sound of wind as
right.
if he's flying. But Bud Collier, host of To Tell the Truth, other claim to fame, voice of Superman.
Right.
And he used to end every episode with God bless.
Interesting.
Yeah.
That was his have your pet spay or neutered.
Yeah, and it wasn't, wasn't controversial. The cast in this episode, actor playwright Ozzie Davis. Look at that.
How odd.
Being defined as a playwright. Yeah. Ozzie Davis, the great actor.
Who you all know from Bubba Hotep as JFK.
Yeah. Joins panelists Peggy Cass, Tom Poston, and Kitty Carlisle.
Tom, very early Tom Poston, too.
Well,
Most
Tom
people
Poston.
Don't know him until the Newhart stuff.
That's right, yeah, as the hilarious dopey custodian on Newhart. But Tom Poston, his claim to fame was the Steve Allen show.
Okay.
Oddly enough. When Steve Allen got his Sunday night show, which was actually called the Steve Allen show for real, in 1956, Steve Allen, it was a scripted program, which is what differentiated from the Tonight Show
right.
he was doing. It was put on the air by NBC to compete against Ed Sullivan,
okay.
who dominated Sunday nights on CBS. So they created this show, The Steve Allen Show, and because it was scripted, they hired a cast of comic actors.
Right.
And among those comic actors, and their kind of like first big break, was Tom Poston,
okay.
Louis Nye, a guy named Gabe Dell, who had been a Bowery Boy, and Don Knotts.
Right.
Don Knotts and Tom Poston got their big break at the same time.
From Steve Allen.
And then Tom Poston went on to do a few movies and was a regular To Tell the Truth panelist.
Yes. Interesting.
Kitty Carlisle was the wife of Moss Hart, the famous playwright and collaborator of George S. Kaufman.
And Andrea Martin used to play her on,
yes.
on SCTV somewhat frequently.
Right,
yes.
right. Well,
she had a very distinctive laugh.
Right, and they parodied her on The Simpsons as
yes,
well.
Yes.
Come on, everybody, let's play the
yes,
game.
Yes.
Yeah. A very Broadway, socialite, kind of just bubbly, lots of pearls around her neck.
Right, right.
Peggy Cass was, like, very brassy. She was sort of like a perennial game show panelist.
Yeah.
She's in every game show panel. I don't...
But what she was famous
yeah,
for outside
Yeah, I don't have
of that.
Any other credits for her other than that.
So that's what people were watching on a Saturday night. And what about on the 5th? Anything that struck you the next day?
Let's see. The 5th.
Oh, it's a Tuesday.
Tuesday.
That's a Monday night.
Okay, so this were in the morning, so I see that Davy and Goliath had aired that morning. I would
yes.
definitely watch
Art
that.
Art Clokey is a fascinating man to me.
Did you watch that documentary?
I haven't seen it yet.
I've only seen the trailer.
I've read some pieces about him, and he's very cagey about Davy and Goliath. And I remember hearing, I at one point wanted to read a book on him in the late 90s, and it was very difficult to get any information. And he apparently kind of stopped, my understanding was he kind of stopped doing interviews in the 70s when sort of the college underground comics drug scene
right.
started kind of really enjoying Gumby. And he would get these people that would come up and be like, yeah, man, you know, the trippy. And he was like a very straight-laced guy. And
oh, I heard the total opposite because there's this documentary called Gumby Dharma
right.
all about how he left his family in the late 60s to go to Haight-Ashbury and do LSD.
So maybe that's why you wouldn't talk about it in the 90s.
Yeah, and the YouTube trailer that's out there is all Art Clokey talking about his LSD trips and how important they were to him.
Interesting. Interesting. Yeah. Okay, so no wonder maybe I was there was a gatekeeper who was keeping that story.
Yeah, maybe there was a PR person in play who can't let him know that the Gumby creator
was dropping acid.
Yeah. There's a photo of him. Frank Zappa didn't do drugs, but there's a photo of him with Frank Zappa in San Francisco.
Just hanging out.
Yeah, just hanging out.
Makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, Gumby was a seminal. There was a Christian cartoon that aired on TV in these syndicated independent TV stations called Jot, J-O-T. Have you ever heard of that?
I've heard the name, but I don't know the show.
My God, Jot is amazing. Each short is about 5 minutes, so I'm not sure if they use them as filler or if they actually showed a half hour of them.
Right, they might have been a wraparound cartoon.
But it is the most artsy, experimental looking animation. Very late 50s, early 60s, and it's Christian. Each one tells a Bible tale, but the art is mind-boggling. The aesthetics are incredible.
Kind of,
exactly,
out,
the cartoon modern style. Okay, Tuesday night, November 5th, 1963. Well, new sports weather. There is a show on Channel 13 called Talk About Typing.
Yes, which is probably fascinating.
Today,
we won't actually see typing. We'll just talk about it.
Yeah, today's topic is envelope typing. And look who hosts it.
Carl,
no last name.
Carl, the Talk About Typing guy.
Yeah.
That sounds like an Adult Swim show now. Like if you had a guy named Carl talking about envelope typing for 10 minutes,
yeah,
they would be like, this is genius.
There's a carpentry show I found on YouTube from the 50s. I posted it on WFMU a few years ago because it's so entertaining. I forget what it's called, but it's like a Mr. Fix-It Shop show.
Right, right.
And he teaches you how to build a sawhorse.
Right.
And it takes 18 minutes,
yeah.
And it's just him sawing and nailing. Like, he doesn't even talk while he does it.
Well, because why would they? Again, they're sort of inventing the genre at this time. The editing, why would you do that?
It is like just this blissful experiment in the mundane.
Right.
It's quite incredible.
And at 7, this person's watching My Three Sons, which does not surprise me, but the show that intrigues me, which we get no explanation of, is Camera Goes to College on Channel 5 at 7 o'clock on the Tuesday.
Yeah, there's no write-up on what that is, because I guess everybody knew.
Everyone would know. It's Camera Goes to College.
Camera Goes to College. I have nothing to add
Lost
to that.
Lost to the Sands of Time.
My Three Sons. My friend Ernie is the name of the episode. Chip and his new sidekick, Ernie. They're jumping the shark here. Chip and his new sidekick Ernie are lost in the woods in this episode. Stanley Livingston's brother Barry becomes a regular as Ernie Thompson.
Yeah, and that show was on for like 12 seasons. Like,
yes.
That show went
forever.
Well into the shaggy hair, bell bottoms
era, right.
And it was very, very jarring when you would see those back to back, like a 50s My Three Sons,
yes.
And then a psychedelic.
Yes.
Same with Dragnet, when you'd see those weird 60s ones that kind of never late 60s ones.
My favorite ones, yeah.
They very rarely would show those, and they're not the Dragnet people remember.
Right. Well, it's the Dragnet I remember, because Harry Morgan is the sidekick in that,
right.
Not to be confused with Henry Morgan,
Harry
Morgan. But yeah, My Three Sons and Beverly Hillbillies and a few other sitcoms of that era, when they entered that hippie era, and then they started introducing hippie characters,
yeah.
Or like there's protests in the background.
Yeah, it's
so weird.
No. Yeah, it's very, very strange.
There's always a joke in there, are you a boy or are you a girl?
Yes.
Laugh track laughs, and
right.
Then the aho woman comes in and goes, aho.
And hey, man.
Yeah. Of course, I'm sure you must have talked on your podcast before about the Gomer Pyle episode in which Rob Reiner is a hippie who sings Blowing in the Wind with Gomer.
And I also love the Car 54 or Are You show, where this is more of a beatnik thing, but it's very hippie, where Joe E. Ross goes undercover in a bank as a hippie.
Wow.
Yeah.
There is a beatnik episode of My Three Sons.
Yes.
But the writers of My Three Sons were so square that the beatnik episode is like from 1965.
Right, right.
Well
right.
Past the beat generation.
I mean, Dobie Gillis was well tread at that point.
Yes, yes. Let's see what else. Route 66 is on.
Great show.
With special guest star J. Carroll Nash, one of the most prolific character actors of all time.
One of my favorite episodes of that show is with Lon Chaney Jr.
It's the famous one.
Yeah.
Peter Lorre, Lon Chaney, and Boris Karloff, right?
Yes.
Great one to watch on Halloween. There's an ad on the same page for Route 66 that is drawn by Al Hirschfeld,
yes.
The famous Broadway caricaturist. Martin Miller, the co-star of Route 66, became the co-star of the Dragnet spin-off Adam 12 in later years.
Adam 12.
One Adam 12. I love Adam. Living in Los Angeles gives you a whole new appreciation for Adam 12. although most of that is shot in the Valley, someone and most of Dragnet is shot in Los Angeles.
Someone told me I looked like him one time. Was it Ken McCord?
Kent McCord, haircut looks
That's
a little bit
pretty
like
much
Kent
what,
McCord.
Yeah, people would also say you'll like Mad Men because of your haircut.
And did you?
No.
Oh, okay. I don't see what the correlation would be.
I don't either. It seems very weird.
I don't necessarily prefer bald actors, but Larry David does love Sergeant Bilko because it stars a bald man
actor.
In glasses.
Yes.
The Red Skelton Show is on at 8 o'clock on November 5th, 1963. I never liked Red Skelton.
I never
found him funny. Another person who was on TV forever. 20 consecutive years. Sometimes at the top of the ratings, sometimes at the bottom, but always on the air. Again, most of it filmed not far from here. CBS Television City, where they do The Price is Right Today and Bill Maher.
Down on Melrose or something?
Beverly and Fairfax. Yep. And it was the state-of-the-art television concourse when it was opened in 1953. In fact, there's a great CBS special based on the launch of that facility with all the stars, and they show you all the behind-the-scenes cameras and the curtains that have CBS logos on them.
Because until the early 50s, most television was produced in New York.
Right.
Movies were produced in Los Angeles.
Exactly.
And it was was CBS the first one that moved their production out?
Yes, it was the first one to have a specific facility devoted to it. So there had been other TV shows done here, but they were done from theaters that were meant for live shows.
And it was like a special event when they do like Los Angeles Week or something.
Well, Alan Young did his show here. Ed Wynn did his show on Vine Street, 1735 Vine Street. Theater's still there. It's the same theater they did the Jerry Lewis talk show in 1963. They had renamed at the Jerry Lewis Theater, but it got canceled after 9 episodes, so they had to rename the theater
something else. It
became the Hollywood Palace, which is a great variety show that was sort of like a competitor to Ed Sullivan between 65 and 70.
Great episode of that hosted by Frankie Nanette from 1968.
Oh, wow. That sounds fantastic.
It's very good. I'll make you a copy.
Yeah, all of those Hollywood Palaces are great. That show came to TV in a pinch because Jerry Lewis got canceled so quickly and so suddenly and unexpectedly, and it was such an expensive show they lost so much money on.
Right.
They needed to do something super cheap, super fast for primetime Saturday night at 9 p.m. So they just did the Hollywood Palace, which was, we'll just hire a celebrity to read off cue cards and introduce a band that already has a song and a comedian that already has a 5-minute set.
Right. Which is what television's become now.
Yeah. But that theater's still there, 1735 Vine Street, and they did some early TV shows there in the late 40s in Los Angeles. But yes, you're right. Most TV was in New York in the 1950s and slowly moved it way out here. Red Skelton had his show at CBS Television City.
Red Skelton always struck me as sort of a terrifying bruiser. I don't know. I don't think he has a reputation, but as a kid, when I would see him on TV, he looked like an old man that would punch you.
Yeah.
I don't know what it was.
Yeah, I think that's true in real life, too. He was an alcoholic of sorts. Also, just like Bud Collier, ended every episode of his TV show saying, God bless.
Right.
Was considered a Christian family man. The tabloids had to... always had a scandal ready to go, and somebody had hush money to pay them off.
Right.
Red Skelton was, you know, famous in movies with MGM in the 40s. He was the height of mediocrity. In comedy, the biggest stars are always average.
Yes.
They're not the funniest. They're not the worst.
Milton
they're always
Berle.
Average. Milton Berle, but even today, like Dane Cook or Kevin Hart or Russell Peters, and that's not to slam any of
them. But that's how you appeal to a wide variety.
That's exactly right. So that's why Red Skelton was on the air for 20 years, because he wasn't that great.
Right.
He was good enough.
Right.
Yeah.
The less specific you are, the more people you'll appeal to.
Red Skelton did his show for 2 years up the street, where the Chaplin Studio is now at La Brea and Sunset, or it's where the Chaplin Studio always was.
Right.
But Red Skelton owned that concourse, I think, from 60 to 62.
Okay.
Moved his operations over there. It was Red Skelton Studios. But yeah, I never, ever liked him. And then in the mid-60s, they tried to hippify the Red Skelton show.
Right.
They made a deal with Brian Epstein, the guy who had been, you know, a major impresario for the British invasion.
Right.
And they did an exclusivity deal with the Red Skelton Show that he would introduce a new British invasion band every week, like
which
the Animals, the Dave Clark Five.
Which was clearly in the wake of the Beatles, Ed Sullivan.
Exactly. But they had some, like, grungy ones on there, too, like the Yardbirds.
Right.
And it's Red Skelton saying, please welcome these darling guys from England, the Yardbirds.
It's the Trogs.
Yeah, exactly. So there was that weird thing. But
which
I never liked
the bizarre culture clash where, you know, we didn't really get teenagers till the 50s. They kind of didn't exist. You were a child and then you were an adult.
Right.
And television took a little bit of time to catch up to that. And the guys who were used to appealing to what would have been teenagers before they kind of had a name in the 40s, who were really young adults, you know, 18, 19 year olds, now don't know what these things are.
Right.
Like, it was really, people downplay that sort of generation gap, but it wasn't just that there was an age difference. It was, this was a whole group of people that kind of didn't exist.
Right. Well, there's certain film studios, you mentioned Frankie and Annette, AIP, the studio that made those Beach Party movies, and coincidentally also had their base of operations where Red Skelton would have his base of operations in the Chaplin studio. They were there from 58 to 60, and then Red Skelton was there from 60 to 62. AIP had this mandate that they would only make movies that would appeal to teenagers,
right,
because the film studios never made any movies
that
appealed.
And that's that how appealed. They made a ridiculous amount
of money. Bazillions
of
dollars. Yes, the teenagers would go to the drive-in to see people that were their same age.
They were the ones with time and money.
Yeah, and they would use the word teenage in the title. Yeah. I was a teenage Frankenstein.
Yes.
I was a teenage werewolf, you know. And for good reason,
right.
You know. It was all marketing, but they were very deft, very smart.
AIP movies, we got inundated with in the 80s on television.
Sure, yeah.
Those were the packages, like the shop theater packages.
Yeah, when I got cable in the 90s, there was a channel called the Speed Channel.
Yes.
And it was all about fixing cars and stuff like that. But every Saturday, they showed a movie.
The Last Drive-In?
Yes.
Yes, with Bruce Dern would host
Bruce
it.
Bruce Dern, The Lost Drive-In.
Lost Drive-In, that's right.
And that's actually, I'm so young, that was my introduction to Bruce Dern, was that show, him hosting it.
Mine was The Burbs.
Oh, yeah, maybe I'd seen The Burbs. Maybe I'd seen The Burbs. But, you know, Bruce Dern would do this, like, Hamlet soliloquy in a empty, abandoned drive-in and hold, like, an old speaker like it was a Yorick.
Right.
And say, the last drive-in.
Yeah.
Nobody comes here anymore. Used to hear all the crowds. Now there's just nothing.
I have a few episodes of that as well.
Yeah. And then he would introduce a great AIP drive-in movie about cars or teenagers, and I fell in love with all the AIP stuff, man.
Absolutely.
Still to this day, I love...
Most people now would probably see them, or the genre, on like MST3K.
And then later AIP did all the blaxploitation movies in the 70s.
Corman came out of AIP before he founded New Concord.
Right, and Roger Corman. Yeah, a lot of people did stuff for AIP. And all the Beach Party movies, too.
Yeah, absolutely.
McHale's Navy is also on in this TV guide shortly after Red Skelton.
Did not like.
Had a lot of good actors in it. Joe Flynn, who played the authority figure, the guy with the horn-rimmed glasses. Great character actor. Appeared in a lot of those bad but charming Disney movies in the late 60s and early 70s that the young...
Candleshoe. Jodie Foster was in many of them. Yes,
yes, yes.
The Cat from Outer Space.
Whose name am I trying to remember? Goldie Hawn's husband.
The computer wore tennis shoes. It's Kurt Russell.
Kurt Russell. Joe Flynn is in a lot of those Kurt Russell Disney movies. Ernest Borgnine said that he only accepted the role in McHale's Navy for one reason. He'd gone to somebody's door for some reason, like a neighbor, and a child answered the door and said, I recognize you. Are you from... Yeah, and then Ernest Borgnine started rattling off his credits.
Yeah.
I did the movie Marty. She goes, No, that's not it.
Kid wouldn't know that.
I did the movie The Wild Bunch. No, not that. The kid said, I know who you are. And he identified him as like some TV star who wasn't Ernest Borgnine, but somebody else.
So he said, I should do TV.
Yeah, Ernest Borgnine decided he should do TV because nobody recognized him but didn't know his name from movies.
You ever heard the Kurt Russell Disney story, the famous story about... So when they found Walt Disney dead...
Right.
He was clutching a piece of paper where he had written Kurt Russell on it.
Oh, no way.
No one knows what for.
Wow.
I imagine he was, you know, saying we're going to do another movie and get Kurt Russell. But that he was like 13 years old and they were like, you know,
when we
found him dead, he just had a piece of paper with your name on it.
That's incredible.
That would freak me out.
I did not know that. Had Kurt Russell already done child acting?
He had done several Disney movies and Elvis movies as well.
Right, that's fantastic. I did not know that.
And then he was a professional, he got signed as a professional baseball player and had given up acting, got an injury, and then went back into acting.
I like all of those live-action Disney movies that are like pre-74.
Right, Pete's Dragon.
Before Tim Conway fucked it up.
The Gnome Mobile, before the Apple Dumping Ring.
Yeah, before that. I like all the ones with Kurt Russell because I don't know who the person was in charge of the casting department, but they cast nothing but brilliant character actors.
Yeah.
All those movies are full of recognizable faces, and they're all solid, whether it's Kathleen Freeman or William Shallard or Joey Ross. Right. You know, they all appear in these things.
They're almost
great.
Like store brand Mad World.
Right.
But just on right. that on that respect.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Right. McHale's Navy, this episode also, of course, has Tim Conway. It has Carl Ballantyne. You know anything about Carl Ballantyne?
The name's familiar.
He did a presentation house act in the late 40s. Long before Albert Brooks or Steve Martin ever did the same thing, Carl Ballantyne did the bad magician act.
Yes, okay. Yes.
And that was his claim to fame.
He was on Car 54, Where Are You?
Yes, correct.
And he was also on Night Court, one of his last roles, where he played sort of a TV magician from the 50s.
Oh, I did not know that.
Who Harry had as an inspiration to getting into magic, but who was actually just now an old con man.
What has happened to Harry Anderson?
Harry Anderson owns a comedy and magic club, and he's moved back to New Orleans, and where he grew up.
Right.
And he owns just some like magic
right.
shops.
He's like the Ray Combs of New Orleans.
Exactly. But I don't
still
believe
alive.
He killed
yeah.
himself.
Okay.
Yes. But that episode specifically was very interesting because he was basically playing sort of a Kreskin type character, like a Harry Black. Blackstone.
Kreskin, another Canadian-American co-production in the 70s. Kreskin
yes.
was all over Canadian TV.
Yes.
And so was Ravine, the Impossibilist, who was a hypnotist who never had a career here. He was from Australia. His entire life, he just toured back and forth.
Between Australia and Canada?
No, just across Canada, playing recreation halls, you know, and people always love a hypnotist audience
Absolutely,
participation.
Sure.
But I think he briefly had a TV show. His records are very common in thrift stores.
Hypnotist records?
Yes. Quit smoking, put it on as you go to sleep.
Oh,
that kind
actually
of
self-hypnosis type stuff.
Yeah, a lot of those. But he had the classic look of the hypnotist with the goatee that comes to a point.
I think
big
you mean to
hair.
Say the classic look of an evil hypnotist.
Yes, yes. But he didn't bill himself as a hypnotist. He billed himself as a impossibilist.
Okay, not a mesmerist.
Ravine the Impossibilist.
Right.
But he and Kreskin were very popular for some reason in Canada in the
Carry
70s
on.
And 80s.
Canada loves magic.
I don't know. I don't know what they love.
Isn't, the 70s magician. Thank you. The rainbows and mustache. Oh my God, it was so 70s. He's a 70s magician at several variety shows. Doug Henning.
Oh,
Doug
yeah.
Henning's Canadian.
Well, I don't remember getting Doug Henning as a child where I grew up, but...
I believe he was Canadian. I may be wrong.
Sounds like a Canadian name.
Yes.
All right, well, we should wind up here, but let's see before we go what else I can discover in this TV
guide. What's popping out at you here?
Well, you know, it's... I'm really amazed by the level of simulcasting going on, like multiple channels with the same things. You Don't Say, which is an interesting game show that had a lot of celebrities on it, hosted by a guy named Tom Kennedy, who was a great game show host who eventually took over Password Plus from
okay.
Alan Ludden.
Yep.
His brother is also a game show host named Jack Narz,
okay.
N-A-R-Z, and he hosted a show called Now You See It, Now You Don't, and was the announcer on one of the Steve Allen shows.
I'm intrigued by this Ed McMahon show because Ed McMahon fascinates me as a human being.
Missing Links,
this
yeah.
Is Missing Links. And Tom Poston, again, I assume this is a panel game show.
Missing Links, it was a game show of some kind. And look at this, Seven Keys hyphen Narz.
Yes.
N-A-R-Z, that's
so
the brother
Narz
of Tom
hosting.
Kennedy, yeah.
I wonder if their parents were proud or felt like they
and
did
then,
something
and
wrong.
And then Pete and Gladys starring Harry Morgan. Everybody we've mentioned
right,
is coming
right.
together.
They're all coming together.
Missing Links, Ed McMahon, that may have been, I could be wrong, but that could have been his game show, which actually originated from Philadelphia.
Okay.
Where he got his start in Philadelphia. I don't know what region this TV guide is from.
I don't
from.
Know he, either. I'm not sure. It usually says on the top masthead.
Philadelphia.
It's a Philadelphia issue. So
there
that's
you
still
go.
A regional show.
So this is before Ed McMahon, I guess, joined Johnny in the Tonight Show. Or maybe
right.
simultaneously. These and might be reruns.
He was from Lowell, Massachusetts.
Ed?
Ed McMahon originally, yeah.
I know he got his start in Philly TV.
I often say this, but there's several... he's from not far from where I live. And
right.
there's several, like, very 1960s donut shops still there.
Oh,
and
yeah.
when you walk in, it's just tables full of Ed McMahon. There's, like, 40 guys that look like Ed McMahon in there. It's great.
Are there headshots autographed on the wall of Ed
no,
McMahon?
No, we have Killer Kowalski headshots.
Oh, that's nice.
Yeah.
I like that. I do love 50s and 60s wrestling footage. I mean,
yes.
it was all over TV.
Yes.
Again, cheap, simple,
but
easy.
But it would be, like, real, like, midget wrestling. And
right.
it would be much more gimmicky.
Midget wrestling was invented in Canada by a hustler in Montreal. I forget his name. But there was this impresario. Wrestling, a lot of the big wrestlers through history have come from Canada.
Rowdy Piper.
Bret Michaels is more recent in his family, and they had a famous thing in Calgary called the Dungeon, where their abusive father raised all these famous wrestlers by beating the shit out of them in the dungeon.
Hey, you know, you got a superhero origin stories have to happen somewhere.
Andre the Giant came
from France.
From Europe through Canada, wrestled in Canada first before he became a star in America.
This may be apocryphal, but I think he's from the same village in France as Hervé Velliches. I've heard that somewhere.
Wow.
Which would be, like, what's going on there?
That's interesting. I don't know.
Search that up.
Yeah. Midget wrestling was invented in Montreal, and Andre the Giant used to wrestle midgets frequently.
I do want to mention, maybe my favorite thing in this entire TV guide is a documentary on Wednesday night, November 6, 1963, called World's Girls. And it says, the mysterious creature called woman is given more than just the eye in this worldwide exploration of her charms, aspirations, and dilemmas.
So you could never say that to a girl. Hey, baby, I'd like to give you more than just the eye.
More than just the eye.
Yeah, that is...
That sounds pretty fascinating.
A lot of these news documentaries are completely lost to time.
No one kept those. None of these were for posterity.
Oh, my favorite writer is also on an episode of David Susskind's Open End, which was a public television talk show, which was tried to be more erudite. David Susskind was a Broadway producer who fancied himself a talk show host. He was not a good talk show host. But he had a lot of great guests. This episode has Norman Mailer, Nelson Algren, William Goyen, James T. Farrell. But Nelson Algren is my favorite writer, and if I rip off anybody, it may be Algren. He wrote two famous books that probably most people haven't read, but they would know the names. The first is called The Man with the Golden Arm.
Yes, yep.
It became a famous movie starring Frank Sinatra and Arnold Stang with a great, great soundtrack by Elmer Bernstein. It's a book about heroin addicts in Chicago in the late 40s, and it's very bleak and it's very good. His other book is where this famous phrase came from. His other book is about Chicago streetwalkers, prostitutes, in the late 50s. And the name of that book is Walk on the Wild Side.
Right.
And that's where that phrase comes from.
Right.
So Nelson Algren wrote those two books. He hated the movie Man with the Golden Arm. He didn't get along with Otto Preminger. He thought he was sanitizing his book.
Yeah.
And surely he was. Frank Sinatra playing a heroin addict.
Yeah, I'm not buying it.
Arnold Stang, Milton Berle's sidekick, who's hilarious, playing a junkie.
It's not the same. It's certainly not the same.
Great soundtrack.
Did you ever read Harlan Ellison's Glass Teeth books?
Yes, I love them both.
Back to what we were kind of talking about at the beginning before we finally wrap up, is that those sort of came out of that 70s television film historian era.
Sure.
But those were so ahead of their time in that they weren't historical records. They were taking the next step of, I mean, those books seem so what we would see in the 90s.
They're historical record now by accident, you know, because they're compendiums of his weekly column. So it was about what was coming up on TV next week, what he had seen on TV last
week. It's like Harlan Ellison's TV guide.
But he's got, you know, Harlan has one of the all-time great attitudes, and it always comes across in his writing. For years, when people wrote about TV, it often didn't have much of a bite to it.
Right.
Although, surprisingly, these old TV guides are often very caustic.
They're very editorialized, because it's totally anonymous.
Yeah, you think it's going to be puffery promoting things, but they are tearing, you know, you'll read TV guides from 65 and the fall preview will say, will this finally be the year where they finally make television for adults to watch?
Right.
No, it isn't, you know, and they'll go off tearing it apart. And
yeah, the anonymity of TV Guide really makes some true snark in these old
Of course, issues. Cleveland Armory is the famous writer from TV Guide who got his byline in here. There was another guy named Richard Gehman, G-E-H-M-A-N. He was known as the King of the Freelancers because between 1950 and 70, he wrote something ridiculous, like 10,000 freelance articles in Cosmopolitan, Red Book, TV Guide. He ghostwrote a Jerry Lewis... Well, he didn't ghostwrite it. He shadowed Jerry Lewis for this biography called The Kid in 1964. And the last chapter is all about being backstage at that Jerry Lewis talk show debacle.
Right, that was getting canceled.
Mm-hmm. It's well worth reading, Richard Gehman. And Jerry Lewis called him The Beard. That was his nickname. Because he looked kind of like Ravine the Impossibilist, Richard Gehman. And he has cameos in a few of the 60s Jerry Lewis movies.
Cinderfella.
Yeah, he might even be in Cinderfella, The Beard. And then I guess one of my favorite things as I'm looking at this TV guide is the morning schedule or the afternoon schedule. I miss regional TV when the weatherman had to dress up as a sea captain and introduce Popeye
kids cartoons.
So in this child slot, November 8th, 1963, there's Cap'n Jim's Popeye Club.
Yes, which we know exactly what that is.
Yeah, a bunch of kids on a bleachers probably getting some candy and prizes. Are you ready for another cartoon?
Here's another Popeye.
And then Channel 12, I don't know if you've talked about this on your podcast before.
Uncle Pete?
Uncle Pete. You
Uncle
know
Pete
all about it, right?
Uncle Pete has come up, yes. Uncle Pete has come up several times.
Again, because this is a Philadelphia TV guide. Uncle Pete is Peter Boyle's father, right?
Yes, and he was blind.
Was he?
I believe so. I may be remembering this wrong, and people email me if I'm wrong, but on the episode with Amy Sedaris and her family went on the Uncle Pete show, and he was a legally blind host or television show.
Right.
And
he
I think he called David a little girl or something like that.
That's fantastic. Uncle Pete, father of the great actor Peter Boyle from Young Frankenstein and Joe and so many other things, and was a huge star in Philadelphia. Everybody knew Uncle Pete, but most of us in other parts of the country, no idea.
Well, Philadelphia was sort of like, before television really moved to LA, was like TV's LA for New York, because you also had Dick Clark getting his start out of there with American Bandstand, which was a Philadelphia show, and Philadelphia kind of was the
Mike
second Doug- city.
Mike Douglas. Yeah.
And then just kind of fell off the map for TV.
Right. It's very interesting what was considered a media hub then. But, industrial America in the Midwest, these used to be booming towns.
Right.
Detroit was big for TV and radio. Same with Philly. Yeah, any industry area where there was a big population, it had that then. And Pittsburgh had the very first radio station in the history of America.
Right.
Detroit is interesting because across the river in Windsor, Canada, regulations were different. This is a little bit off topic, but there was a radio station in Windsor called CKLW, also had a TV station, and everybody in Michigan received it.
Right.
There was some kind of regulation where you could not have a certain amount of wattage in a certain area under FCC rule, but the same rule didn't apply across the river. So CKLW had the most powerful wattage of any radio station in the Northeast.
And you can't make it directional, so it's going to go over the border.
So it went all over America, but because of that, it was the most influential musical tastemaker in America all through the 1960s. Motown,
Canada.
The sound of Motown, literally Motown Records, spread to Philadelphia, Pittsburgh, New York, all that region, and became popular
of
because of CKLW.
Interesting.
Yeah.
It's almost like the pirate radio stations in the UK on the boats.
Right. CKLW had a great sound. It had great DJs. You can find air checks, but I don't think it ever really got its due as how influential it was.
It's rarely name-checked when people are talking about the classic rock and roll
CKLW, and they also had a TV station that was small-time because it didn't have that reach called CKLW Channel 9. Now, Cap'n Jim's Popeye Club is competing with Uncle Pete. At the same time, they're showing a movie made by AIP that appealed to teenage drive-ins called Attack of the Puppet People.
Yes.
Starring John Agar, who was in so many of those movies.
And this is a classic case of what AIP was known for, which was selling a poster, then making the movie.
Attack of the
Puppet People is one of the classic examples of that.
And it's about a group of people that shrink. The guy who directed it, his name is Bert I. Gordon.
Yes.
And this was a big
change.
It was a big change of pace for him, this movie, because usually he made movies about things that grew really large.
Amazing Colossal Man,
War of the Colossal Beast, Village of the Giants, Empire of the Ants, about giant ants, Food of the Gods, which is about giant farm animals.
Food of the Gods 2, which had a lot of nudity.
Did he direct that, though?
Didn't direct it, no.
Village of the Giants is about giant teenagers.
Which has the brothers. Bo Bridges
is in it, and oddly enough,
Howard.
Yeah, oddly enough, the Bo Brummels do the opening song. Bo Brummels, Bo Bridges, Ronnie Howard.
Yeah.
Tony Basil, Hey Mickey, You're So Fine, You're So Fine, You Blow My Mind, who looks great, by the way, I saw her recently. Bert I. Gordon also made Beginning of the End, which is about a giant cricket. He made a movie called Earth vs. the Spider, which is about a giant spider. But this movie, Attack of the Puppet People, is about tiny people. So
because
Bert I. Gordon,
The Incredible Shrinking Man had been a hit.
That's right. Yeah, it was the year before. Jack Arnold directed that. Jack Arnold also directed Tarantula. He also directed Monster on the Campus.
Yes.
And he directed many episodes of Gilligan's Island, Love American Style, that kind of stuff.
Which makes sense. I mean, a lot of those people went from low-budget movies into the episodic television because it was pretty much the same kind of schedule.
Exactly. They can shoot fast. Right. William One-Shot Bodine became a big TV director because he had been making B-Westerns in 3 days.
Right, absolutely.
But you're absolutely right. That is the reason. And then Friday, November 8th, 1963 at 11:30, it's Johnny Carson. That is The Tonight Show.
Yes.
But it's also listed at 11:20. Steve Allen's at 11:15. It's interesting, when Conan O'Brien was explaining on TV why he said no to NBC's suggestion that he start The Tonight Show at midnight and
right.
Jay Leno as an 11:30 lead-in, Conan, who usually knows his history, said The Tonight Show has always been at 11:30, and to
right.
me, The Tonight Show means 11:30. But it wasn't true.
Right.
The Tonight Show has not always been necessarily at 11:30, and it has not necessarily always been an hour. In many regions, it started at 11:15.
Right. They would pop in. Some people would miss the first 15 minutes.
That's right.
Right. Because radio would do that often.
Right.
And it was a holdover from radio.
Right, right. And one of the other reasons, and also, for a long time, The Tonight Show was 90 minutes,
right.
not an hour. It's more a recent phenomenon that it became 60. One of the reasons was they could sell that last half hour to regional commercial affiliates or
right.
to have regional commercials on each affiliate. And so those affiliates would make more money.
Absolutely.
It was strictly a cash grab for the affiliate, not for the network.
And that's why SNL is a 90-minute format, still to this day.
That's the reason?
Right, because it was in that slot in the mid-70s, they were airing reruns of The Tonight Show.
Right.
And they said, why don't we put something new here instead?
Right, right.
So it
right.
had to be a 90-minute format, because it's a holdover from that era, but it's unusual to have a TV show in a 90-minute format now. And in fact, SNL seems to be, I think, the only one that still is.
This is sort of interesting, and then we'll wrap up.
Yes,
I know we
yeah.
keep saying that. But November 8th, 1963, Friday night, there are three people listed on this page, three different shows. The names are Jack Parr, Steve Allen, and Johnny Carson.
All three hosted
this. It's the first Tonight Show host, the second Tonight Show host, and the third Tonight Show host. The third Tonight Show host, Johnny Carson, is the one who's actually hosting The Tonight Show on this page. They don't list his guests, unfortunately, but the Jack Parr program that's listed here just says Jack Parr, but the name of this show was the Jack Parr program. It was
right.
his primetime show that he took over after walking off of The Tonight Show
right.
on the air, quitting on the air. Johnny Carson was his replacement. He went back to TV on Friday nights only. I had heard that it was at 8 p.m., but here it says it's listed at 10 p.m.
Right.
Jack Parr welcomes Jonathan Winters, Phil Harris, who was a band leader and Jack Benny sidekick, and Alice Faye, who I think was Phil Harris's wife, and Jose Meles, who was Jack Parr's orchestra leader on The Tonight Show, came
right.
over with him. But Jack Parr is really responsible for Jonathan Winters' fame.
Right.
He pushed him hard on his programs, both The Tonight Show and the Jack Parr program, and allowed him freedom to just improvise.
To do what people think of
yeah.
as Jonathan Winters.
No stand-up routines, no pre-screened interviews, just improvise. And really, that's what made Jonathan Winters famous, and it was when he was at his best.
Right, absolutely.
Without a net. So Steve Allen is on the same Friday night at 11:15. On Channel 2 and 33, 1963, this must be a Westinghouse syndicated version
right.
of Steve
and
Allen.
Only one name I recognize in the lineup there.
Who do you recognize?
Mel Torme.
Mel Torme. Songstress Janice Baker, never heard of her, just a girl singer. Louis Nye is a character actor and comedian who was in that coterie of people I mentioned in 1956.
The
Tom Poston,
people.
Don Knotts,
right.
Louis Nye. He had a hangdog face. Great looking face, bags
sure,
under his eyes.
Him, probably.
He often did a gay character that always got big laughs.
Right.
Steve Allen would do like a fake man in the street and say, "Hello there, sir. May we speak to you?" And he'd go, "Oh, you want to talk to me?
Right. Big laughs,
am I
right,
on TV right now? Hi ho." You know, he would do this fake character. But it's interesting to see that Friday, 1963, Jack Parr, Steve Allen, Johnny Carson, all doing different shows. Neither Steve Allen nor Jack Parr would ever be as successful again as they had been as the hosts of The Tonight Show.
Right.
And likewise, Johnny Carson was just about to become the most successful he would ever be as the host of The Tonight Show. It was really a potent program in those days.
And I do want to point out, too, that finally here, before I go, because I brought this up frequently, also competing with those shows is bowling. And it's live at 10:45 p.m.
My God.
Make that spare. And it's Harry Smith challenges Johnny Johnston reporting.
Wow.
And that was 1045 live bowling. It was the most watched sporting event on American TV at that time.
Right.
Because it was the easiest to broadcast.
It's only 15 minutes long.
Yeah.
Channel 4 cuts to the news at 11.
It's like one match.
And then the same night, the movies that they're showing, The High and the Mighty, one of the rare non-Westerns for John Wayne that he produced in that era, is playing. Also competing with a movie called Bell, Book, and Candle
that movie.
Ernie Kovacs is in, one of his few fine film roles, and Jack Lemmon's in it
Jimmy
as well.
Jimmy Stewart's in it too, isn't he?
He is. And 11:20, it's The Gay Divorcee, one of the great Fred Astaire, Ginger Rogers musicals, filmed, again, not far from where we're sitting right now, up at Melrose and Gower's, where that movie was made. A Western called Jubal with Glenn Ford and Ernest Borgnine, again, a name we already mentioned. Boomtown is a fun late show movie. Clark Gable and Spencer Tracy and Hedy Lamarr. There's a great episode of To Tell the Truth with Hedy Lamarr on it when she's older and she looks gorgeous.
Right.
That aired maybe like 2 or 3 weeks before she was arrested for shoplifting.
Excellent.
Yeah.
She was the Winona Ryder of her day.
And then the last late show movie of this night, November 8th, 1963, is called Hitler's Madman.
Not too far after actual Hitler was around.
Yeah, apparently a movie about Hitler wasn't enough. They had to make one about his sidekick, Hitler's Madman.
Hitler's Madman.
Featuring, of course, John Carradine, who's in so many of those movies.
Yes.
But reading the description, when his native village in Bohemia is subjugated by the Nazis, a young Czech in the Royal Armed Forces returns to lead his people in freeing themselves from the Nazi yoke.
Yes.
Y-O-K.
It's very similar to The Frozen Dead, one of the fine Nazi zombie movies genre that exists without the zombies.
And probably better than They Saved Hitler's Brain.
Yes, yes.
Which is not that great.
No,
is it
really isn't. As a concept and as a movie. Well, Kliph, thank you so much for doing this and for flipping through the TV Guide. I really enjoyed learning. Not that my guests aren't smart, but I rarely learn facts.
Well, I'm sorry if I talk too much.
No, not at all.
But this is fun. I love going through these TV Guides. You got a great concept for a podcast.
Oh, thank you.
And it's been a delight.
There you go. A wealth of information. A genius, Klph Nesteroff. Canada's own Klph Nesteroff. You can find him at Old TV Showbiz. Just Google his name. It's written and spelled in the title of the show, so you can find it there. And pre-order his book. It is going to be great. You will really enjoy it. If you like this show, you will love anything you read by him. And as always, you can email me, canadicanread.com or tvguidancecounselor@gmail.com. We also have Twitter. I'm at Kenneth W. Reed, or the show is at TV Guidance. Here's a secret. They're both me. I know. And I love hearing from you guys. So let me know anything that you think, questions, or any feedback you have on the show. It's great to hear from you. And we'll see you again next week for a brand new episode of TV Guidance Counselor.
You were gone. Where's the anchovy? I am a real fraud. I like just doing it in my underwear at home between porn sites. The biggest stars are always average. Hey, baby, I'd like to give you more than just the eye.